The Indianapolis Motor Speedway, the racing capital of the world, on a day that is warm, very humid, and dripping with tension and drama down along the pit lane and back in the paddock. It's bump day as the field of 33 for the Indianapolis 500-mile race will be squared away. The first of 35 cars to compete today for those 33 spots heads out onto the speedway. It's young 21-year-old Zach Clayman DeMello from Montreal, Canada, who will be the first to take to the giant 2.5-mile track. Couple of warm-up laps before the green flag, then Clayman DeMello sets off as well as the other drivers on the traditional 4-lap, 10-mile attempt. Today, it's bump day. They'll determine which 33 of the 35 cars will be in the field. They'll all requalify tomorrow to determine their actual grid positions for the 500-mile race 1 week from tomorrow. And so it begins the nervous day for many down along the pit lane. Not nervous at all. In fact, one somewhat celebrating today. Alan Bestwick, Eddie Cheever, Scott Goodyear here in the booth. I hope you got up early to watch the royal wedding. Obviously, he did.
I did.
Happiness of the wedding aside, nervousness along the pit lane. You've both been in position of having to scramble to make the 500 field. What's today like?
Today, you're all by yourself, and you have only one job, go as fast as you can. But you don't have to have an engineering degree to understand that if you make a mistake at these speeds, it's going to hurt, and you probably will not qualify. But you can't hold anything back, Scott. You have to give it everything you have. And I remember my heart just pounding through my chest every time I try to qualify here.
And you said something, it's all up to you, it's an individual. So for the driver, you feel that weight on you because you are by yourself. You're the only car that's on the racetrack. Everybody in the pit lane can hear your throttle modulation if you lift it for a turn, if you're flat out. And so once you get the green flag, it's your job to go as fast as you can. And for drivers, as you mentioned, Eddie, today it's all about getting the job done.
So in his first attempt to make the field for the Indianapolis 500-mile race, Clayman DeMello on the clock, again, 4 laps around. It is the average speed of those 4 laps that will determine the make or break number today. Clayman DeMello, of course, filling in for young Pietro Fittipaldi, who was supposed to drive Dale Coyne Racing's 19 car in this race. Fittipaldi injured in a crash at Spa-Francorchamps in a World Endurance Championship event a couple of weeks ago. Suffering injuries to both of his legs, Fittipaldi, back in the United States, was here at the Speedway the other day, giving everyone an update on his recovery and his progress. But Clayman DeMello, who was sharing this car during this season for the 19 team, getting the tap on the shoulder to drive in this 500 unexpectedly.
And that's a very respectable first lap. That's what we have seen here in the last couple of days of drivers going out in what we call no-toe speed. So when the drivers are out there practicing, the real rule is if you can see a car in front of you, you're generally getting some type of a toe aerodynamic assistance, which increases your speed. So now drivers, the only car on the racetrack today, like we mentioned, it's all up to you. We watch his speeds. We've seen this 225, 227, but a lot of fluctuations sometimes in lap times.
I think the fluctuations in the lap time is caused by the fact that it's new equipment and nobody really has any past history with it. So every time they go out, they learn something. But I will tell you, those are the loneliest 4 laps you will do all year long because you cannot come in the pits, you cannot adjust the car, you have what you have, and you try to eke out every tenth of a mile, try to straighten out the wheel, try to go as close as you can to the wall, and above all, look in the bottom of that screen, that throttle. It should always be 100% green if you're going to be quick.
1 lap to go for Clayman DeMello. Yeah, Elio Castroneves, 3-time Indianapolis 500 winner, 4-time Indy 500 pole winner, said these 10 miles, 4 laps, are as stressful as the full 500-mile races a week from tomorrow.
And it truly is. And just remember, when we were doing it, Eddie, you had one qualifying attempt to get out there and make the show. Here, they're going to qualify. You have an opportunity to withdraw the car, requalify again. So multiple runs and a lot of pressure. I'm not sure if I would have wanted to do that.
Checkered flag for Zach Clayman DeMello. And the first 4-lap run of the day is in the books. And the 4-lap average speed for Clayman DeMello is 225.722 miles per hour.
I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that's not going to be enough to make the top 33.
Ryan Hunter-Reay, the former 500-mile race winner, getting ready to go, sitting, waiting for the signal. Race director Kyle Novak, which he has gotten. And so while Hunter-Reay begins his warm-up laps, let's talk about that number. You mentioned the new 2018 IndyCar in use here at the Speedway for the first time. What we've seen so far in, again, most of the week's practice has been getting ready for the race, trying to understand the car for race trim. But yesterday, when they went into kind of full-on qualifying mode, when the engine boost, the turbo pressure was turned up, and the extra speed added that they're running with today, everyone's trying to figure out what the limit is on how much aerodynamic downforce you can take off of the car to where the point is it's too much in the car, and you're not gaining anything, and also you're risking the driver losing control of the car and crashing.
That is a subject that we'll be talking a lot about in the next day, but it is... In the past, you got to a point where you started taking downforce out of the car and you continued to go quicker until you reached a point where you started sliding.
Hunter Ray winning this race after a terrific fight in 2014 with Elio Castroneves. The pass almost in the grass, heading down to turn three. What a spectacular, intense, heart-pounding finish between the two of them. Had a red flag, remember, late in the race, had to restart for the final scramble to the finish. And Hunter Ray with the traditional swig of milk and kiss of the bricks as a 500-mile race winner.
Very popular win. Hunter Ray is very methodical in how he approaches the Indy 500. He's always in the run. And I think with these new cars, the way he approaches racing, he has been learning more and more as the week has progressed, and I expect to see some good numbers from him today. But when it comes to races, when he really excels.
Well, don't forget, they didn't start their testing with this new universal aero kit, the new bodywork, like a lot of the other teams did, because there was some discussion last fall whether they were going to change power plants, whether staying with Honda or going to Chevy. So they sort of fell out of the line, if you will, out of the queue to be having an opportunity to turn around and get some testing done. So they started very, very late in the testing program.
So while Hunter Ray continues on the track, let's head down to the pit lane for the first time and check in with Jan Bikas.
And Scott Dixon is just about to get into the car. Well, actually, just one quick question. Yesterday you suffered from a migraine. How are you feeling today?
Yeah, much better. Yes, it was definitely not the right timing for it, but, we made a couple of runs there. The car seemed pretty good. You know, hopefully we'll run some fast laps here in the PNC Bank car. It's obviously going to be a tough day, but we'll see what we can make out of it.
All right, thank you, Scott. He's eager to get in the car. He's only a few cars away in line. And obviously, guys, the conditions down here at the moment are perfect for fast speeds.
74 degrees is the air temperature. Track temperature, 85 degrees, 80% humidity. And yes, a chance of some pop-up showers as we go throughout the afternoon. That also, if your first run doesn't go well and you're hoping to have time to make another run, that just adds to the pressure of the day. Not only watching the times and trying to re-engineer your car, but watching the weather radar too.
Well, we talk about the weather radar. When you go around here, drivers are always looking at the windsocks. There's one down the pylon, and there it is up on the top. It's not even moving today, Eddie. So telling drivers, you don't really have to be so concerned about the wind. There's another one at the end of the long back stretch in turn three. Drivers today will maybe take a peek at it, but some days you're here qualifying and you're watching it every time you go down the straight. Today, they'll be just worried about where they're placing the car in the turns. No concern about the wind.
I love this camera on the front of the car.
Isn't it great?
This is incredible. And you can really feel the speed. You can feel the inherent danger that's sitting there in case something goes wrong.
Final corner here for Hunter Ray of this qualification run. And the checkered flag awaits the former winner. And he will go to the top of the board at a 226.916 mile an hour average. So Hunter Ray just edging out Zach Clayman DeMello, who's standing by with Rick DeBrule.
Well, that's right. The rookie Zach Clayman DeMello. So we have to ask, what was it like running a qualifying run here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway for your very first time?
It was definitely exciting going first for my first time here. It was, I'll remember it for a long time. It's definitely something that's pretty special to me. It wasn't really the qualifying we wanted in the number 19 pay save, but it happens. It's a really long race, and anything could happen here.
What went through your mind yesterday when your number was drawn first?
Well, first of all, I wanted to draw because I'm really superstitious. And then when I pulled two, I was like, well, at least someone will go in front of me. And then it ended up I happened to go first. And, it is what it is. It's part of the game. And it was exciting to go first, and definitely wasn't the easiest, but it is what it is.
All right. Once again, Zach Clayman DeMello has qualified, but he's expecting to have to go back out and do it again to get something faster.
And the reason he went second after pulling the number one, Indianapolis continues the tradition of all of the team's backup cars that are entered as a T car or a test car. And one of the T cars actually drew the number one. So Clayman DeMello actually the first of the race cars to go. Here's Jack Harvey, the 25-year-old from England, looking to make his second Indianapolis 500-mile race start. Came here a year ago with Michael Shank Racing, veteran of, well, first of all, Shank, a former IndyCar driver, but a veteran of fielding teams in the IMSA Sports Car Series. Partnered up with Andretti Autosport a year ago. Now this year, partnered up with the Schmidt-Peterson team. And talked to Harvey the other day, feeling pretty good. He said, second time around at Indy, so much different than the first.
It really is. And, you know, we remember what it was like when we came in our rookie year. For me, 1990. You come back the next year and you've now got an understanding about what this place has in store for itself. Not only the racetrack, but just the event itself. When you come out for qualifying, the pressure that Zachary was talking about, I think all these things you have to take in for the very first time. And, oh, yeah, by the way, you have to go out there and try and drive 225 or 230 miles an hour. A difficult task.
What really got me when I first came here, having come from Formula One, it was just the pure speed. Yeah. You are never below 220 miles an hour. So it just takes a lot to get used to. And I think for a driver that comes here for the first time, maybe not having had Formula One experience, it must be a lot to absorb. So when you look, if you really want to see what a driver is feeling before they go out and qualify, focus on their eyes, because they are looking way down the road because they're about to have a really difficult run.
While we watch Jack Harvey make his qualification attempt, we check again with Rick.
Yeah, checking in with Ryan Hunter-Reay. Just finished your run. Let's talk about what it's like out there with this car this year.
It's different. No doubt about it. It's different. You know, it's in traffic, it's much different. I think the race is going to race more similar to what we had probably in 2009, 10, in there, 11. So but so far, you know, we've been making good strides. The team has. This DHL car has been, it's been a little bit tough to get the speed out of it so far, but that was a positive run. I was hoping for a low 227 ultimate speed, but didn't have any fall off, so I was getting really aggressive with the tools in the car, and I think it's a good run, but I don't think it'll stick around for much. We're going to have to get more aggressive here later in the day.
How hard is it to go back out and do it again?
Well, when you consider Fast Friday, right, and you're just constantly throwing less and less downforce or peeling less and less downforce off the car, and you're just trying things constantly, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday are the three longest days in racing, no doubt, for a racing driver. You know, before I left the timing, the engineering shed, the engineers were like, all right, monkeys to your rockets. And that's what we're doing.
Right. Ryan Hunter-Reay knows he has to go out and do it again.
Well, that's great insight from the former winner and former champion, Hunter-Reay. Again, it looks like we'll see him later this afternoon from what he just said there. Harvey now coming around to complete his four-lap run. And so just a recap of the rules. Everyone gets one guaranteed attempt to make a qualification run. Once that time passes where everyone has gone through the line and received their one guaranteed attempt, that's when the gambling begins and people start shuffling in and out of the qualifying line, and it'll get to be really, really interesting as the afternoon goes on. He's back. Well, actually, from here, he never left. But Elio Castroneves, the three-time Indianapolis 500 winner, not running the full IndyCar series this year. Roger Penske has moved him over to his IMSA sports car program in the Acura Daytona prototype, but back here at the Speedway, ran the road course race a week ago, and is here in the 500 looking to see if he can join that such exclusive club of four-time winners. ...2001, 2002, 2009. Horses for courses. Elio Castroneves has had the feel for this speedway since he came here, and the results, year after year, even when he's not winning the race, he's in the hunt.
When we saw Ryan Hunter-Reay win, who was behind him? Elio Castroneves. He is always there. He's always a contender if he's running.
Who finished second a year ago? Elio Castroneves.
What's amazing about Custer Nevis is that he gets better and better every year. This place is very treacherous, and in a race, there's lots of these little bear traps that are all over the place, and you have to see them coming to avoid them. Traffic can be very difficult here, so there can be an accident happen maybe 300, 400 yards ahead of you. You have to be on top of it before you get there. You cannot look like you do in most races just off your front nose. You have to assimilate so much information here because, as I've said earlier today, it is just so fast. And there's the man behind it all, Roger Penske,
the captain, who is the race strategist for Castro Neves, as well as the owner of four entries in this field, 16 times a winning team entrant in the 500-mile race. And from what we've seen in practice, both in race trim and on Fast Friday yesterday, the Penskes are tough this year. Now, this also brings up the manufacturer competition, Chevrolet versus Honda. Remember, a year ago, the story here at the Speedway was the Hondas came up with a little something under the engine cover and had the measure of the Chevrolets, and the Penskes all started back in the middle of the pack. Well, so far, what we've seen in practice is the revenge of the bow tie, if you will, not including that one you're wearing, Scott. Chevrolets look like they've found some grunt and might have a little bit of an advantage in this year's race so far.
And I think now with Elio on track with the Chevrolet, that will probably give us a very good indication of where Chevy is going to sit. Like we said, we've seen speeds of 225 to 227 for cars running by themselves. Speeds a lot higher, obviously, with that tow that we talked about. But here will be the true test to see what they have to offer. And Eddie, you know, I was coming here before. The engine manufacturers, everybody leaves just a little bit on the table until qualifying time. So now the truth will come out.
But let's remember that these are not special engines just for this qualifying run here today. These are the same engines that are going to have to run the full 500 miles. So you're right, you have to squeeze everything you can out of them, but the main goal is not to qualify on pole and then have a bad race, but to have a very strong race. And the farther you qualify up the grid, the less possibilities you have of getting involved in those very easy accidents to have at the start of the race. It's a perfect run.
Well, I'm looking at it. It's in sixth gear, just getting close to 12,000 RPM maximum. They've actually engineered this car perfectly.
So, and he just hit a 228.924. No, a 229.
That's his average so far. That lap was over 229. And that is the first lap over 227 that we've seen so far, and he did a 229.
And that 2 mile an hour spread that we talk about, you feel that inside the car, inside the cockpit, because everything starts to go a little quicker. The distance between turns 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, we call that the short shoot. So this is a pretty great time, and he's got one more lap to go here. We're going to see if he continues being consistent, which is exactly what Ryan Hunter-Reay was talking about.
Another
229, this is raised the ballpark. You mentioned you didn't think, Eddie, that the 225s, 226 would get in there, and I'm going to agree with you.
And look at how much room he's leaving on the track.
Which tells us the race car is handling very well. He doesn't have to use all the road. The car's not sliding up the track a little bit, going towards the wall. It's very controlled.
He's trying to run the least amount of distance he can, turn the steering wheel the least amount possible.
And the checkered flag for Castro Neves. Fourth lap, down in the high 228s. Four lap average, 228.919 for Elio Castro Neves. And he is the new leader early on this first day of qualifications at the Indianapolis 500. Three times a race winner, four times a pole winner. It's another fence climb in the offing a week from tomorrow. Castro Neves finished for now.
I wasn't going very far.
Sometimes I just forget.
The double play is like a dance with me, second days. Ah, Jose and Carlos are the perfect dance partners. Indians, Astros, tomorrow at 8 on ESPN.
Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, where Spencer Pigot has just taken the green flag. The 24-year-old from Orlando, former Indy Lights champion, looking to make his third start in the 500. Spencer driving for Ed Carpenter Racing, another group of Chevy-powered entries that have shown some speed in the Fast Friday no-tow timesheets yesterday.
Ed has had some fast cars here at Indy, and I think it's very special for him, obviously, because he's from Indianapolis, but I would expect to see a big number from his cars today.
Well, there we go. And that 228, certainly he'll see that immediately on his dash, on his steering wheel, know the speed. And now your thoughts are, what do I need to do to keep the car going with this? You heard Hunter Ray talk about using the tools inside the car. Drivers can use the roll bars front and rear. They can also use what they call the weight jacker to distribute the weight on the car to change the handling or improve the handling throughout the run. So no doubt, that's exactly what he's going to be doing as the run continues to go on.
He's using a lot more road than Castroneves was coming off of two.
Speaking of Elio, Rick.
Yeah, we're standing by with Elio Castroneves, who's watching that qualifying run. And we were just talking about the fact that you were able to go up on your speed after the first lap. How?
Well, I was just feeling the car a little bit more. Didn't make many adjustments. But Shelpin's oil machine was actually pretty dialed in. I think not only my car, but Will, Simon, and Newgarden was pretty close. So right now, we're working very well, trying to make sure that Chevy Power keep pushing us up to the front. But certainly, when I saw the 229, I was like, oh, I thought it was 228. So I have to like compose myself. But it's amazing how those cars became so sensitive by the last lap. The car, you really like driving. Normally you say tippy toes, but here you say literally in your tip of your fingers. It's like just to make sure you don't do any enough like aggressive moves. So it was pretty... it's pretty amazing. It's going to be a very, very close qualifying. Let's see. Still a lot of people to come, but got to get ready. Get ready, because now with the rules, you can go back. Hopefully the rain stays, and then we can go back out there and try to defend this this position.
All right, Elio Castroneves hoping for a little more speed.
Hi, Rick. Thanks. Here is the checkered flag for Spencer Pigot. You see on the tracker that yellow dot, the yellow arrow. He is tracking second fastest so far, and that is indeed where he slots in. At an average of 228.052 miles per hour. So Castroneves, Pigot, Hunter Ray, Clayman DeMello, and Harvey, the first five to go. Scott Dixon sits in line at the head of the grid and getting the signal to head out onto the speedway now. Dixon, a former winner of the 500 2008, now looking to make his start in the for the 16th time in this race. Of course, the 15th will be one that will be long remembered for that. When Jay Howard got forced up out of the groove, caught the wall, came back across in Dixon's path, and he took an absolutely terrifying ride into the catch fencing and the inside safer barrier. Somehow, some way, look at Castroneves going under Dixon, by the way. Scott walked away from this wreck, beaten up, but walked away. And now back here at Indianapolis again, hoping for much better days 1 week from tomorrow.
I get the shivers every time I see that.
Shows you how strong these cars are, because he was able to step out of the car underneath his own power. Built as a deformable structure, but that safety cocoon, if you will, that they sit in, the tub itself, Eddie, is probably the strongest single-seater tub anywhere in the world.
So Scott Dixon, a three-time pole winner, you see, including a year ago. Remember the late drama we had on Sunday in the Fast 9 when Dixon came out on top? Getting ready here on his final warm-up lap to come to the green flag. You heard the interview with Jan earlier. Limited practice for this team yesterday when the boost was turned up to what it is today for qualifying, because Scott suffered from a bad migraine. But back in the car today, taking the green flag here and setting off on his four-lap, 10-mile journey.
Still in fourth, Scott.
I saw that, and a lot of times you can have three top gears. So let's listen here as he rides along.
They were really optimistic, thinking they were going to use fourth, fifth and sixth.
As we know, sometimes these top gears can only be 125, 150 RPM different to each other. Speed's going well. You can see him starting to use the cockpit adjustments, possibly the adjustment for the weight jack. You can see his hand behind the graphic on the steering wheel starting to make some adjustments on the car. We've heard this and we saw how much Spencer Pigot's last lap dropped off. This is the job of the driver right now to make sure that he tunes the car as the car is changing.
He's not going to like this run.
227.650 was the first lap. There is Chip Ganassi. Who knows what it takes to field winners here at the Speedway. Second lap for Dixon will be 227.680.
Now, guys, when you see times so consistent like that, 227.650, 227.680, the driver is doing an amazing job getting everything out of that car that he possibly can and driving it consistently. And as we heard Elio talk about it, you're just trying to gingerly turn the car into the turn without turning the steering wheel too much and just using your fingertips, because the less that you turn the steering wheel, the less speed you scrub off and the less RPMs drop off and the more speed you'll get out of the car. But right now, I think he's getting max out of this car, Eddie.
I agree. Let's go back to the battle between Honda and Chevy. This team, this driver, is one of the big guns for Honda. So for him to be this far off is troubling if you have a Honda engine. And that's exactly the opposite of what was happening last year. So getting back to what Alan said, Chevy definitely went back after last year's loss and found something. And it's turning out to be a horsepower battle between Chevy and Honda more than it has been in the past.
Because of the aerodynamic changes to the cars. Absolutely. And some of the things that they can't do this year. The cars have more drag on them in this trim than they did a year ago. So it's only so much downforce you can take out of it. And a lot of people think that in the race, horsepower and the difference in horsepower, gearing, things like that, are going to be a big, big deal.
So that's the only variable.
227.5 for Dixon, third out of six. Ray Hall, who struggled in practice on the track very shortly.
We really like having Aaron around, but we're concerned he takes his name a bit too literally.
Okay. He has to do golf again.
Like all rise.
Live on bump day at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. 35 cars for 33 starting spots in next Sunday's greatest spectacle in racing. Here is Jay Howard in a Schmidt-Peterson Motorsports Honda machine. Howard, on the clock, he's had some very good speed, but as we talked with Jay yesterday, they've kind of ridden the Indy roller coaster of the week. One day the car's fast, the next day they're struggling, the next day they're fast, the next day they're struggling as they work their way through the checklist of items to get down to this point today.
Well, you can see there again that this car is showing that it's in fourth gear. The same thing that we had with Scott Dixon's car, Eddie, you and I offline during a break were having that discussion. You know, are they really in fourth? Was that just something wrong in our telemetry? But if you were going a little quicker, maybe you might end up in that fifth gear. But for Jay, you talked about that roller coaster. He's got enough experience here that he really will not be affected too much by that. For Zachary, who was the first run that was out there, maybe he turns around and could feel what the weather can do to a race car here. And sometimes you can try to overdrive it and make a mistake.
So while Jay Howard makes his run, let's hear from Spencer Pigot, who's sitting in second.
Yeah, Spencer Pigot got out of the car. You were actually smiling. You said it felt pretty good. Explain that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, for us, it was a solid run. I think the average is about 228. So, you know, I think at the looks of it so far, that seems to be pretty quick. Obviously, there's a lot of cars left, but our preferred freezer car has been really solid. And, you know, I think we're confident that we'll be in the fast nine. But, you know, if we have to go out again at the end of the day to get ourselves in there, I think we'll be happy to do so.
All right. Right now, Spencer's number two on the day.
Heidrick, thanks. Talked about Jay Howard. This is third Indianapolis 500-mile race. He guess the word I want to use is passionate. He's so passionate about being in this race. Jay Fields, driver development program for a lot of the rest of the season, helping young drivers come along the way, but he is so passionate about being in the field and competing in the Indianapolis 500.
And you talk about that young, the passion that he has for young drivers, runs a great karting program around the country, developing young drivers, and has also started the F4 team that has actually just won races here recently. One of his drivers leads the championship for the Formula 4 USA series, which is a part of a worldwide series. He's looking for young drivers, young development, and might even be an IndyCar team owner one day. Certainly has that passion.
Fifth out of seven for Jay Howard, 226.098, the four-lap average speed. So I mentioned Graham Rahal, one of those that's got a lot of pressure on him today, Jan.
Yes, indeed. So much pressure. As you hear Ed Jones fire up in the background, the next in line will be Graham Rahal. So much pressure, he chose not to speak with me before he got into the car today. And you're looking at a brand-new chassis and a new engine. You speak about the Honda runners looking for speed. Graham Rahal and his team has been looking for speed, could not figure out why they didn't have the speed they wanted, so they went to their spare chassis and a different engine for today. A wholesale change. Now, if you're wondering, why is he not taking his position for his spare car? That only comes into position after you've gone through tech if you have to go to a spare. You still take your original position if you just choose to change your chassis before tech for qualifying.
So we were talking, Alan, about pressure.
Yeah.
He spent the whole week in a different car. He knows it. They tried things. It didn't work. When you make a change like this right before qualifying, Alan, that means you've gotten to the bottom of the barrel. There's nothing else left to do. This is pressure times five.
And I'll bring that other word back, passion, right? The Rahal family with success here in this race and passion and probably nothing more that Graham wants to do, period, than join his father as an Indianapolis 500 winner as you watch Ed Jones make his warm-up lap. So pressure and passion, and to come here, be a championship contender, feel like you're going to contend to win the race and be frustrated and not be able to figure it out. Goodness, how tough is that? There is Bobby Rahal winning this race back in 1986. Driving for the late Jim Truman. What an emotional victory lane it was as the elder Rahal sipped the milk. So Ed Jones on the track now, his second Indianapolis 500-mile race. This year driving for Chip Ganassi Racing. A year ago, came here for the Dale Coyne Racing Team in his first try, qualified 11th, and finished third, which is one of his two podium finishes in IndyCar racing. A spectacular debut here at the Speedway for Ed Jones a year ago. While we watch Ed Jones on track, let's hear from his Ganassi teammate with Rick.
Yeah, standing by with Scott. And first thing we have to ask is, how are you feeling today? I know you had the migraine problem yesterday.
Yeah, much better today. It was definitely a rough day with the migraine, but woke up feeling a lot better today. You know, we got to run a couple of laps yesterday, which was, you know, definitely, you know, nice to just make sure we got some running. We didn't run this morning. A couple of people only ran this morning. So the PNC Bank car felt good. You know, it's just we're lacking a bit of speed. We can't seem to find that little bit of speed that we need. But the team, you know, has been working, you know, through the night effortlessly, like, you know, the rest of the team's trying to make the most of it. But right now we seem to be stuck kind of where we are.
So the guys in the booth were noticing you were running in fourth gear for a time. What's the story on that?
Yeah, I think the first lap or maybe the first two laps we were in fourth. You know, it's hard. You don't want to shift during the run because it, you know, can kill some of the speed. But, you know, we'll just have to see where that takes us later. I think ideally I should have started the run in fifth gear. Maybe it would have given us, you know, another half mile an hour. But, you know, we'll see. You know, we'll reassess the conditions for later today, later this afternoon, and see if we can get the PNC Bank car back out there and have another crack at it.
All right, Scott Dixon has the experience, that's for sure.
And the advantage of having teammates. So here is Ed Jones, Dixon's teammate, out there running in fifth gear.
Very well put. That's what you have to do. That's why multiple car teams have a bigger advantage here at Indy, because you have to learn from every session, especially with these new cars.
Chip Ganassi, a five-time Indy 500 winning entrant. Last win was back in 2012 with Dario Franchitti. 231 miles an hour into a corner, a 90-degree left-hand corner.
And they're not all the same. Everybody says they're the same, but they're not. You know what I find funny is that Ed Jones now with Chip Ganassi moved to Indianapolis so he could be closer to the team. And he's actually staying over in the motorhome lot this month so far because in his building downtown, they're shooting some commercial and some movie stuff around town. And it's so noisy there, he can't get any sleep at night. So he came over, says, I moved to town to get close and, to the team and stay in my own bed at night, and I got to sleep in the motorhome lot.
Checkered flag, four-lap average, 226.995. Ed Jones, fourth out of eight that have gone so far. Of course, Ed calls Dubai home. His U.S. base was Miami until he went to work for the Chip Ganassi Racing Team and made that move here to Indy. So here is Graham Rahal. When you look at the no-toe results, so the timing and scoring here at Indianapolis and in IndyCar, sophisticated enough that they can sort out on track when a car is getting help from a draft in front of it and when it's not. And in yesterday's practice session, Graham Rahal was 34th fastest in the no-toe speeds. Again, a driver contending for the championship.
Whoa. And did you see how far he was out of the line, Alan?
Out here, searching out, trying to find enough speed to at least beat two cars today to be in the field.
But the biggest difference, Scott, is right now he cannot come in. He has no choice but to keep his foot on the throttle as long as he can in hope to get a number that's good enough to qualify.
You know, you and I both have lived this. We talked about being on the last row because there's bumping going on here. You and I have both lived on the last row to start the Indianapolis 500 before. So it's difficult when you're so used to being competitive and winning races as Graham has done. You talked about the heritage of the family. You just now are thinking to make sure that you get into the field because there's cars to be bumped out. So when you don't have the speed, you've lived it. I lived it. There's his father, Bobby, right there waving the green flag to signal that they are accepting the start of the four laps to qualify here at Indianapolis. The pressure is more when your last name is an Andretti or Rahal, as you and I have talked about.
You're absolutely right. In fact, I remember in 1993, I had a battle with his dad. And I knocked his dad out with 4 minutes to go. So this is something that they know and they have lived. And you never expect to be in this position. And if you look at his line, he's dancing right on the edge of that razor blade. If he puts that right tire, another quarter of a foot, he's going to be into the gray. And the gray might have grip, and it might not have grip.
And the frustrating thing about this is, you've been here, you've been on the track practicing since Tuesday, even yesterday, practicing with the qualifying boost and so on, and you haven't found what's keeping you from having the speed. Now you come out here today, you swap the chassis, you swap the engine, and you go out and make this run, and if you haven't found any more speed, what are you going to come up with to throw at it later today to try and get ahead of a couple of cars? Right now, he's tracking ninth out of nine to run, including himself.
Well, I'll tell you one thing he cannot do, Alan. He can't use any more road because there is none left.
And that wall doesn't move for
you. No, and it bites back. I've done that also.
Well, okay, if you want to pick on me, the safer barrier does move, but not much.
They both hurt, Alan.
Yeah.
I can assure you.
He's doing everything he can to wring as much speed as he can from this.
And so you talk about using all the road. He's trying to turn the steering as least amount as possible to try to get the speed out of the car. When you go into the turn, you're hoping that the car rotates itself and just rotates on its axis in the middle of the turn and freewheels itself out. And for his car, that's not doing it for him right now.
And he's using his gearbox going up and down from fifth and sixth gear.
All three laps in the 225s so far. Very consistent laps. 225.3 for all of them. But right now, to get up and at least be ahead of two cars,
holy,
he's going to have to be in the 226s for that four-lap average.
Oh, he'd have to do a 232 now to do that.
You know, it's interesting. In the press conference the other day, one of the reporters asked Bobby if, you know, he gets involved in engineering and with the team. And he says, you know, I really don't. And I sort of let the team do its own thing. Interesting, we went past the garage this morning to talk to the drivers. And Bobby was actually in the garage by the engineering session. And, you know, they're probably just trying to draw on some of Bobby's experience.
Checkered flag, Graham Rahal, eighth out of nine, 225.407 for the four-lap average.
Look at this.
Oh, like you said, on the edge of the block where the drift was to the gray.
He had 4 inches left, at least.
All right, so Graham Rahal is done. Orioles Serbia scheduled next, and we check with Jan.
Yes, and the much-anticipated qualifying run for Danica Patrick is coming up. You've just arrived at your car. We saw Graham Rahal just have a moment because he's been searching for speed, but your cars have been solid. How confident for your qualifying run do you feel?
Yeah, I saw that they were going to cut away to a replay of something not good, so I just went like this. You just want to feel confident. I mean, I think that's the thing at Indy is you need to be very respectful of this place because we're going so fast and things can change very quickly, but you also have to drive it with confidence. So you have to be very sure of yourself and believe in it. So hopefully the car is as easy to drive as it was for the most part yesterday, and hopefully it's all that bit as fast and hopefully a little bit more, and the goal is to be one and done today, but I'm driving for a great team with Ed, so if we have to go again, we'll go again, but having a good time being back at Indy.
It's been a while, and we know the pressure really tends to build for qualifying. How are the nerves?
You got that right. there are many, many different scenarios that are popping up that the memories flood back about what it's like here. And, you know, a lot of it is because you're not sure exactly how it's going to go. I haven't been in the car since, almost 24 hours ago or 22 hours ago. So, but hopefully it's... I do remember times coming here and going out for qualifying and it actually being much easier. So, there's times it's harder, but there are times that it's easier.
We'll hope it's the latter. Thank you, Danica.
Danica Patrick coming up a couple of cars away. First, here is Oriel Serbia, the 43-year-old native of Spain, now living in Los Angeles, driving a third car for Rahal Letterman Leonard in racing, but partnered with one of the top sports car racing teams in the country, Scuderia Corsa, out of Los Angeles, veteran of fielding Ferraris. He's up out of the groove.
And he decided it was better to take his foot off the throttle.
Now, the four-lap average for that is done. So at that point in time, for me, I would probably be coming in to see what we need to do to change that.
Just wave it off and forget about it, right?
That was a bad case of push. And push is when you turn the steering wheel and the car just doesn't want to turn.
And it's directly related and tied to your heart rate, because your heart rate goes up.
I think he's going to stay out.
Well, if nothing else, give it another run into turns one and two and see if it does the same thing again.
That was a 201. That won't make it.
No. Sounds weird to say, huh? 200 miles an hour is not good enough?
I remember when Sneva cracked the 200 miles an hour.
Special day, for sure.
And I was told when Parnelli cracked, was it Parnelli who cracked 100 miles an hour?
So he's off the throttle again.
150, yeah. Yeah, 150. That everybody said they would never go faster again.
Well, that's always been part of the allure here, right? How fast will they go? And, you know, when you push the very limits of speed on a closed course, things can happen.
Now, we see him continuing around here, so your mind starts to wonder why. Well, maybe there's some impending rain coming in. You're not really too sure, but more so, if other drivers go out and have a problem, they've had their first attempt, they end up hitting the wall or something of that nature, then they don't have, obviously, a four-lap average speed. So maybe their thinking is, let's just put this in the books and get it done.
Well, I think what he's doing is irritating right now. There's no reason to be out there doing 196 miles an hour when there are people that are trying to do the run. He must have a reason for that.
Rick?
Yeah, standing by with Graham Rahal, and boy, you were hanging on for dear life. Let's talk about that run.
Well, yeah, I mean, we just had to hang it out more than the rest of these guys because the car doesn't have any vehicle speed, you know, and everybody that's here, everybody that's sitting in this place knows what we're fighting right now, and all the other drivers, you know, a lot of guys are really genuine. They come up and they see it. They know, you can see on the app, I have less steering than everybody else. We have less scrub than everybody else. The car just will not accelerate. And so, you know, our guys have done a great job. You know, our guys have just pounded. Last night they were here till 3:30 a.m. They were back here at 5:30. So our boys have worked awfully hard on this United Rentals machine to try to get it into this position. And look, I'm praying we can just sneak in this field. I mean, it's to that point, but unfortunately, that's where we're at.
All right, Graham Rahal just trying to figure out where that speed is lost.
And Oriel Servia just did wave off the rest of his qualifying run, the team choosing to call it off. So no time recorded by Oriel Servia. And an interesting last 15 or 20 minutes here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway.
Sports is our thing.
You good?
And the app gets it. It likes all sports all the time. We're just two best friends that can't get enough sports.
And with the app, we're like a crew. Let me show you what it's all about. I'm
gonna The Indy 500, Sunday, May 27th on ABC.
One of the fastest cars in yesterday's qualification. No tow practice runs on the Speedway now here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Simon Pagenaud, series champion of a couple of years ago, driving for powerful Team Penske. That unmistakable Menards livery on the side of the car. Pagenaud was third quickest yesterday. He's looking to see if he can bump his teammate Elio Castroneves off the provisional pole. And by the way, there's some weather closing in on the Speedway as well on the radar, so that just adds to the thick of things at the moment.
He's using a lot of track also. Castroneves, to date, has been the driver that had to use the least amount of track, the least amount of steering.
And what that tells you, that his car is working. You heard Graham talk about it, and we noted during Graham's run that he had to use up all the track, trying not to turn the steering wheel, scrub speed off. That tells you that Elio Castroneves' car is well-balanced. He turns into the turn. The car does what we call rotates by itself. He doesn't have to put too much steering into it, and then it freewheels out of the turn, and that's what you want. You're driving it on its edge, which only guys like Elio generally can do, and we've seen Elio do that numerous times. He'll probably go out and do it again today if he has to.
Got a look at Tim Sindrick, the president of Team Penske, watching as Pagenaud goes through his qualification run. You know, you were talking about the four corners, even though they all measure the 9 degrees, you know, 12 minutes and so on. This racetrack is so sensitive to temperature and weather and changing conditions and clouds, and you talk about the windsocks and so on. It's almost like the Speedway has a life of its own and a personality of its own. And you're on a four-lap dating run here. You're on speed dating, trying to see if your car is compatible with the Speedway at the moment until the mood changes, like that dark sky back there, and you need something else completely.
And that the track is different now than when Elio went out, because you're talking about the weather, humidity has changed everything. The engineer's job is to go ahead with all their weather stations, looking at all that, and make some final changes on the car before they send you out. But you and me as a driver are getting in the car and going, boy, I hope they made the right choice.
Because you can't go about it defensively. You have to just throw yourself at the corner, full throttle, and just hope that they did their sums correctly.
Thumbs up from Sindrick as Pagenaud flashes by. He will be second fastest, four-lap average, 228.304 miles an hour. Very consistent four laps for Simon Pagenaud. And yes, there it is. The radar looking like that, closing in on us here in Speedway, Indiana. The weather app that I like for its reliability and predictability says light rain in 6 minutes or so, which could be interesting. Jan?
Yes, and you documented the situation for Oriel Servia, and as you can see, they have just arrived at the garage area. He's yet to take off his helmet, but I have had an opportunity to speak with the team. Oriel said on the radio that the car bottomed heavily. They feel that maybe something has broken on this car because they have not changed it since yesterday, and Oriel was quite comfortable with the car at the time. He's now debriefing with the engineering staff. We'll take a quick run in there and see if we can get a comment from Oriel. Oriel, you said on the radio bottoming. You think something has happened with the car?
We don't know. We're going to figure it out now. I mean, we had a perfect run in the morning. The car was awesome, and we didn't touch it. We just put some wax. So I don't know. Maybe the conditions change a little more than we thought. But, man, that opened my eyes out there. I had, like, a couple of big moments. And then I just wanted to stay out and put a time in case it rains. And a couple cars, you know, crash or something. At least we had a time in. But I guess they thought we were too slow, which I understand.
All right, so they will look this car over carefully. The whole team back here in the garage area. Now, remember, anytime you go to the garage area, and you find something, in order to get back in line, you have to fully go back through tech.
Jan, as you were talking about that, we just saw his car wiggle on the entry on the way in. So as that's when I was watching the run, and I initially said, boy, if that was me, I'd be coming in. At 23 years of age, the young drivers today, you'd stay out there and maybe think you can get going again. And, you know, that never works out well. Eddie, you and I both know that. But at 43 years of age for Oriol Servia, I don't know. I've crashed when I'm young. I've crashed when I'm old, and it hurts a lot more when I'm older. So I'm not sure I'd want to stay out there.
Well, you see the umbrellas there. That's James Hinchcliffe looking to stay dry in his car. The umbrellas have gone up. You can see the rain beginning to fall. That old weather app is right on the spot every
brawlies.
Time, isn't it?
They have brawlies.
Brawlies.
Yes.
Says you with your celebratory bow tie
there
for the royal wedding.
That was a very kind way of describing it.
Well, rain delay on bump day here at Indianapolis. Scott Goodyear with a royal wedding update. And more from the racetrack as we wait out this little bit of moisture.
Hello? I wish I was a little bit smaller. I wish I was a baller. I wish I had a girl who looked good. I wish I was like 5'9" on a 3-point line. It's a scandal, but really it was the good kind. When it comes to playing basketball, I'm always last to be picked, and in some cases never picked at all. I wish I was a little bit smaller, y'all. I wish I was a baller. Said I wish I was a little bit smaller, y'all. I wish I was a baller. Yeah.
Under the red flag here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, reminder that our qualifications coverage continues on ABC at 4 Eastern today. And then tomorrow, when they run for the pole and run for their grid positions, we'll be on here on ESPN3 at 2:30 Eastern time. Then we pick it up with the Fast 9 shootout on ABC at 4 Eastern time. Pre-race coverage presented by Pennzoil next Sunday at 11 a.m. Eastern time in the 102nd Indianapolis 500-mile race. Telecast presented by Firestone noon Eastern time. ABC 1 week from tomorrow. We can't wait. So you see drivers getting out of the cars, and we go under a red flag for rain here at the Speedway. We've had 10 cars through so far of the 35. What's the thing you've come away with the most in these opening cars?
Pressure. Nerves, all that goes together. Not only with the new cars, because you don't know how they're going to work. We've seen that. Some guys are fast, some guys are slow. Frustration coming out of Graham Rahal. You've lived it, I've lived it. But now the pressure of the track going to change because it's rain's coming along, taking some of the rubber off. You just hope the engineers, like I mentioned before, do the right thing and the right job. But they're always telling you with confidence over the radio before you take the leave out of the pit lane. It should be perfect. It's that should portion that always used to bother me.
They've never hit the wall with something. The worst thing that with them is back up into a car when they leave the parking lot from the engineer. I have a theory, though.
Yes.
I think Castroneves has gotten progressively better every time he got into the car. I think he has the right engine with the Chevy. Beating Pagenaud in qualifying was another hurdle that he passed. If he keeps this pace up, he's going to continue to build his confidence. And I wouldn't discount him as a probable winner for the up-and-coming.
Not pole, but winner.
No,
we're
winner.
We're going all
winner.
The way.
I'm going,
right.
I'm going past pole.
Okay.
They keep putting things up in front of him, and he keeps jumping over them and jumping over them. He's driving a Penske.
And he has the hunger. No question, he has the hunger. So I can get the royal wedding report from Scott, or we can hear from Simon Pagenaud. I think I choose Simon. Rick?
Well, we're standing by. We're here with the Umbrella Brigade. We got Haley holding the umbrella. Simon Pagenaud standing here. Let's talk about that run. First off, your timing was spectacular, wasn't it?
Yes. We managed to get it in just before the rain. So it's good, you know, because I hate waiting. I just wanted to go. I just wanted to get it out of the way, at least see the performance. And then obviously it's going to be a day with, condition is going to be key for speed. You know, a gust of wind that goes your way, it's going to pick up a lot of speed, or the temperature drop with the cloud coming could be a big advantage. So condition today is going to be what's going to get you up to the front.
So let's talk about, you're about 6/10 of a second, or 6/10 of a mile, I should say, behind your teammate, Elio Castroneves, in average. Where do you find that? How do you change that?
I don't know. That's one of the secrets of Indianapolis is sometimes, you know, you got some super fast stuff going on, and sometimes, you know, another teammate goes faster. I mean, we're trying everything we can at this point, and like I said, it very much depends on the condition. When you're on track, when you go. But so far, the 22 minutes car Chevrolet was really strong, and P2 on the board, and I think it was a pretty strong performance.
All right, sounds good. Simon, go take your picture. I don't even, are they taking? Yeah, they're taking pictures even in the rain.
Waiting.
The official, that's after they qualify, then they go get into position for the official team picture. And it's interesting because it started raining right when he crossed the finish line.
Yeah.
And it just started raining again.
Well, they assemble there on the Yard of Bricks and take the official team photo after the qualification run. You can hear, I think it's some of our microphones, I can hear in my headset certainly, the rain beginning to pound down. That same weather app that told me it was going to start raining in 6 minutes, and it did, tells me it's going to rain for about 35 minutes and then stop. The trick is this big old massive speedway, if it gets really soaked in that half hour, it can take as much as 2 hours to get it completely dry before you send somebody out for a qualification run. Weather dependent, could be shorter than that, but we might be in for a little bit of a delay. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to break away while we wait out the weather delay. Keep an eye on this very spot where you're watching us, and when they're ready to resume the qualification runs on the track, we'll be ready to resume coverage of same. And don't forget, at 4 o'clock Eastern time, the whole thing shifts over to ABC as well. So here we are now after 10 cars have run under the red flag for rain. It's all Chevrolets at the top of the board. Spencer Pigot for Ed Carpenter Racing sits in third. And the front two driving for Team Penske. You just heard from Simon Pagenaud. He set the second fastest run so far. And on the top of the board, the four-time pole winner, three-time race winner, Elio Castroneves is the provisional leader of qualifying as we stop on bump day under a delay for rain. Keep an eye on this spot. We'll be back when they're ready to go back green at the Speedway. The track is dry and we are ready to resume qualifications on bump day for the Indianapolis 500-mile race, a 2 hour and 21-minute delay for rain that occurred after 10 cars had completed their runs. And now James Hinchcliffe strapped in to his Arrow Honda for Schmidt-Peterson Motorsport, about to be given the signal to take off out onto the track and begin his warm-up laps before he takes the green flag. Off and we are back and ready to go. Alan Bestwick, Eddie Cheever, Scott Goodyear here with you at the Speedway. So far, it's Chevrolets dominating the top of the board. 10 cars have run, 3 Chevys, 7 Hondas, and the top 3 are all Chevys. Spencer Pigot in third, Simon Pagenaud in second, and Elio Castroneves, the fastest of the drivers that have run so far, and until it started raining. Again, 2 hours and 21 minutes later, the track has been dried. The sun has peeked back out to help speed that drying process. And we are now ready to go for the resumption of bump day. Here are the drivers that have run so far. Headlined by those top three we talked about, Scott Dixon, the leading Honda in the field. Right now, Jack Harvey is the slowest of those that completed a run. Oriel Servia had a bobble, did not complete his qualification attempt, and he is hoping the rest of these proceedings move through very quickly so he gets a second chance at it today. So here is James Hinchcliffe, the 31-year-old out of Toronto, looking to make the field for his seventh Indianapolis 500-mile race. Hinch comes into this race, fifth in the championship for the Verizon IndyCar Series, but more importantly, the focus here all about winning the 500 as he takes the green flag to set off. You're a driver, Eddie and Scott. You've been sitting around for 2.5 hours. You were the next guy in line to go. Some antsiness, some uncertainty to be the first one to take the track?
Well, what's happened, obviously, since they were getting ready to run this morning is that it rained. And that little bit of rubber that had accumulated on the track has now been washed off. And when you're the first one, you never know if it's completely dry. You hope it is, you think it is, but you don't have any choice but to go out there and just put the pedal all the way down and hold on.
And when you say pedal all the way down, that's what you do in turn one for your first flying laps, your first time lap. Your foot is flat on the gas, as you mentioned, Eddie, and you modulate it depending on how the car is handling for you. So with James, a lot of experience, previous pole sitter here before. Obviously, he's had the big accident here. This racetrack, he knows, plays no favorites and sometimes can be very, very bad for you. So for him right now, the speed is all that he's going to worry about and trying to make sure that he makes no mistakes and just runs his line perfectly.
Now, Hinch has not had the best of solo speed in the practice we saw yesterday on Friday. Those no-toe laps, he was 23rd fastest. So now to string four of them together out there by himself under those green conditions that we discussed before is a bit of a challenge. On the other hand, the reality is, yes, you want to make the fast nine, but you just have to make sure you beat two cars and assure yourself a place in the field at this point with this run if there are question marks surrounding what you're doing.
You are absolutely right. Your prime objective right now is to make sure you get into the field. And like you said, there's two cars that are going home. And it's just the smallest bobble, the smallest, as Scott said, on moving the throttle around can cost you a mile and a half. And as competitive as it is, it's going to be that close. And you can tell by looking at the line of his car right now, he has a little bit of push towards the end of the corner. And what that means is the front of the car is not doing what it wants it to do.
And so when I talk about you want to make sure you beat two cars, right now Hinch is not doing that. He is tracking as the slowest of the cars to have finished their runs. There's Sam Schmidt, the owner of Hinch's car, as well as two others that are looking to be in the field for the 500. And that's got to be a little bit worrisome. Now you sit here and you say to yourself, okay, have the track conditions slowed down? Is everybody else that goes now going to be slower than those guys earlier? Will I get a chance to make another run later on today? What, I mean, I can't imagine how quickly the mind spins when you watch these numbers come in and they're not what you need them to be.
But the driver does not need to have that in his mind. The only thing you need to be thinking of when you're in that car is let everybody else worry about the strategy. Your job is just to go as fast as you can. Then when you come in, the engineers will figure it all out.
And so the slowest of the 11 to complete a run, James Hinchcliffe, again, Oriel Serbia, did not complete his qualification attempt earlier on today. And hello again from the Speedway, Alan Bestwick with the 1998 winner Eddie Cheever, two-time runner-up Scott Goodyear. It's still about the same thing as it was about 3 hours and change ago when we started this. Two people are going to be done at the end of the day today and not have a chance to race in the Indianapolis 500. And I don't imagine that rain delay took any of the stress level off people that are back there in that danger zone.
It just goes up. And if you're with one of the teams that you are very close to what we call the bubble, it's become worse because that time frame that you thought you would have after everybody had their first completed lap, we have a bit more time. Make some adjustments in the car, get back out there, find more speed. Well, as it's going right now, it might get very close to that 6 o'clock bell. And if you're not fast enough at 6 o'clock, you don't come back tomorrow.
Yeah, it's going to be very tricky.
One thing we do know by looking at the numbers that Chevy seems to have a little bit of an advantage this year in qualifying. Last year was the opposite.
Yeah.
Honda had an advantage. Yes. So if you're sitting in a Honda right now and you're in that bottom part of that, in a Honda, in that bottom part of that chart, you're getting more antsy than probably you should be if you had a Chevy. So yeah. it is coming down to a horsepower qualifying race, and Chevy has the upper hand.
So on track now is one of the drivers who is no doubt enormously antsy, James Davison, who had an accident yesterday. You see, everyone is guaranteed one four-lap attempt on this bump day of qualifications. The fastest 33 make the race. Everybody's time's then wiped out, and they re-qualify tomorrow to set their actual grid position. But first, you've got to make the grid. Davison with a crash yesterday. His team worked all night long to repair this car. We spoke with him this morning. Extremely sore. When you have hit the wall here at the Speedway, and you come back the next day and you're sore and you're stiff. If you've ever been in a car accident, you can just imagine what these guys are like after they crash here. And then you got to get back in the car and you got to go again. It cannot be the most comfortable of feelings.
I've often said as we watch his crash from yesterday, if anybody's ever been to a chiropractor, it's like getting 1,000 chiropractic treatments all at once. The back end of the car becomes loose. He goes around and hits the wall. Now, for a lot of drivers here, yes, they're very fit. He goes into the very tail end of what we call the safer barrier, steel and foam energy reduction. So you can see that wall move just a little bit. Helps absorb some of that impact for him. Yes, he's able to step out of the car. But as you mentioned, Alan, when we spoke to him this morning, as he's getting high there on the exit, He is very sore just from yesterday. I've had that where I've hit the wall. I couldn't get back in the car the next day because I had such a huge crash up in turn four. I wasn't clear until the day following. So it's an extra day to work in your mind. When you have an accident, boy, you wish there was another car ready for you right away where you can get right back in and get going. It's almost like falling off a horse and getting right back on.
I don't fall off horses because I don't ride horses.
There you go. So Davison, again, needing to track ahead of at least a couple of cars to make sure he's in the top 33 today. And right now is tracking a little bit better there at the instant that jumped up to ninth quick. So that would be a really tremendous thing for them to come through and file out of this qualification run, his first laps on the track since crashing this car, making the cut line.
You're absolutely right. I want to go back to what you were talking about before about the physical soreness.
Yeah.
Physical soreness you can deal with. It's when something gets into your mind and you don't know why you spun 230 miles an hour turning into turn one. The hardest thing of all is to put that to one side and just believe blindly that your car is going to make it. This young man has a lot of passion.
Yes.
And you can see it coming through today, and he's driving it as hard as it will go. He has not taken his foot off the throttle, if you look at the chart there, and he's on a good run. He's right now, he's tracking to be just ahead of the ones that are going home.
Lost some speed there. And let me correct myself. I knew it was wrong as soon as I said it. He did get a few laps in this car this morning in the morning warm-up since it was repaired. These aren't his first laps in the car since the crash.
Now he's dropping back.
Checkered flag is up. Lost some speed on that last lap, and it might be enough to knock him back out. It's going to put him 11th out of 12 to run. He's just ahead of James Hinchcliffe, and again with Oriel Serbia down the bottom of the list, having not completed a run. Down to Rick DeBrule.
Yeah, and we're standing by with James Hinchcliffe. Obviously can't be happy as a result of that run. And let's talk about how much did the conditions changing affect your ability to go fast?
Yeah, I mean, it certainly doesn't help. You know, we actually went out with considerably hotter track temps than what we originally had. You know, these engines are very sensitive to atmospheric conditions, and with the humidity going up and having the temperature going up, and there's nothing you can do to the cars. You know, you can't plug into them. You can't do anything to them once they're in line there. So who knows? I mean, we haven't been fast nine quick all month. We weren't expecting that, but we definitely weren't expecting what we just saw. So obviously we got a lot of work to do. We still have to get in the show, which is pretty disappointing.
Once again, James Hinchcliffe definitely not happy with where he's at right now, hoping he gets another run in.
As we watch Sebastian Bourdais warm up, talking about the track temperatures, there is where they started at 11 a.m. when the first car rolled, local time here, and where it is now at that 104, 103. How does the increasing track temperature affect the performance of a race car?
Oh, a lot. It can affect the engine. It can affect the handling. If your car is right on the limit when it is cool in the morning, and if you gain 15 degrees, you can take a car that is easy to drive to a car that's trying to kill you every time you turn into a corner. And the drivers know that, so the engineers try to tune the car to the temperature and the state of the track. And it's not an easy thing to do, but with these new cars, the engineers and the drivers have limited information, so they're still learning every time they go out.
So Sebastian Bourdais looking to secure his spot in the top 33. The 39-year-old from Le Mans, France, now makes his home in St. Petersburg, Florida, and has for many years. And is on the clock and on the green flag for his four-lap journey around the speedway. Jan Mikas is on the pit lane.
Yes, and this may be quite representative of what you have in the Honda camp for speed now with these higher track conditions. Sebastian Bourdais and his engineer, Craig Hampson, have been very happy with the car in qualifying trim, but they confess they have not figured out how to make this car work at all in traffic. But, of course, job one today, get this up to speed. Dale Coyne looks on. They're happy again with their alone, without turbulent speed, and he's showing it so far.
You see that tracker jumping up, the yellow number. It was as high as one. Down the back straightaway on that last lap. Lap one complete. Bourdais, 228.336. Remember, it's the four-lap average here. Helio Castroneves, 228.919 was his four-lap average.
That's the fastest one-lap that Honda has done in qualifying today.
You know, it's very interesting, guys, here. The car seems to be working better for him in turns one and two. because that's where he's running up to first and second. That last time through turns three and four where he currently is, he fell back. So you can make the adjustments inside the cockpit, tune the car to the racetrack, sometimes tune it to the end of the racetrack, and maybe that's what he's doing now. So he lost another position there. So he knows that from what he sees on his dash. It's up to him to decide what he wants to do inside the cockpit with the tools that he has to try to repair it for each different end.
Perfect lines. When you follow his car, you don't see any adjustments being made in the middle of the corner. Every adjustment you make scrubs a little bit of speed off the car. The wind is a little bit different than what was this morning.
Just a little. It's still pretty benign. A little bit stronger, but it's not...
And pushing
like,
more into
yeah,
one
like
than
some
it
days it gets here where the wind socks at either end of the racetrack stand straight up. It's not necessarily the case here today. Although it is stronger than it was earlier in the day. So white flag for Bourdais. The fastest Honda at this point is fourth fastest Scott Dixon.
I would say watching this, the Honda engineers have a little sigh of relief.
Yeah, absolutely, because obviously they can't find the speed. It comes down to a combination of the engine and the chassis and the driver and how they tune that car to the driver's liking, to obviously the conditions for the racetrack. But we also must admit that this is one of the smaller teams that's really been punching above its weight, if you will, because they're doing such a great job.
Incredible synergy with him and his engineering staff. Incredible.
Third fastest for Sebastian Bourdais. And after what he went through on qualification day here a year ago, a great relief to see that checkered flag, maybe not on his part, but on our part for sure. Remember, one of the fastest running on a run that would have made him the fastest a year ago when he had just a devastating crash in turn number two. And Bourdais is safely through and third fastest. So here she is, Danica Patrick, back at the Indianapolis 500. Ready to go again in what will be the last drive of her racing career. Headed out onto the speedway now to begin her warm-up laps. The 36-year-old from Roscoe, Illinois, here at Indianapolis for the first time since 2011. Former winner in the Verizon IndyCar Series over at Twin Ring Motegi, ran the Daytona 500 earlier this year, and is now here at Indianapolis to bring down the curtain on her career. Had a conversation with her yesterday back at Gasoline Alley. Scott and I did, and I found a couple of things to strike me about Danica's frame of mind. First of all, the confidence, the self-assuredness, the engaging of the fans that were surrounding her and us as we had this conversation. Really cool to see. But the intensity and the understanding of the emotional roller coaster that a week at Indianapolis is, she made no bones about it, made no apologies for it. She's right in the middle of that roller coaster like all these other drivers, and it's not an easy thing to do.
She has got it well thought out, as you mentioned, but the thing that strikes me, if you take it back to when she came here for the open test, Alan, and she was about ready to run the refresher test the very next day. Remember, she came up to us in the pit wall when you and I were standing there, yeah. And when you said to her, "How you doing?" And she looked at you and went, "I'm nervous."
Yeah.
It's not even a hello we got out of her. It's, "I'm nervous," taken to now that she's been on the track a few times, and the old Danica is back. The confidence was there, as you mentioned today, and she knows what she needs out of a race car, and even the team says, and even Ed Carpenter said, "I'm very proud of her because she's come in here and stuck to her own program, done her own thing with her own car, and she's really got a smart mind about her."
Now, she's also got a fast race car. As we've talked about the Chevrolet versus Honda, this is one of the Chevrolets, not only the Penske Chevrolets, but the Ed Carpenter Racing Chevrolets have shown pace in those no-toe single car speeds that came out yesterday. Danica Patrick was seventh fastest of everyone.
They've shown pace in IndyCar for the past 3 or 4 years in qualifying. His cars have always been quick. But going back to Danica Patrick, she comes from cars, NASCARs, that are a lot slower than these. And for her to be able to make this jump as efficiently as she has done shows the amount of talent that she has in these open-wheel cars.
Another car that's actually, the car is working better in turns one and two than it is in three and four, because she does lose a little bit in three and four. Now, with the wind that it is, and the windsock has just died. I'm looking out of our booth right now, and the windsock has actually gone down from where it was. So this is great for her. The car will handle very well for her, but she certainly seems to lose a little bit here in three and four.
The amount of road that she's using looks very similar to what Castroneves was using. If you watch her on the exit of the corners, she's leaving a lot of room, just like Castroneves did, who is currently quickest.
So lost about a half a mile an hour on that second lap. 27, I say down to. I guess everything's relative.
Well, you know, and I'm watching here right now. I call it shallows the car in. She sort of guides the car in, sort of low, maybe a little bit soon, ends up a little bit high on the exit. Everybody has their own preferred line. We watched Elio. He was a later on the turn in, got down closer to the white line. It's all about what the car will offer you and what will give you. But as you talk about, guys, to come here and be flat out around this racetrack and to see the speeds that she's doing is completely incredible. And she doesn't come here under the radar. She comes here with a lot of pressure on her.
Very tidy run. Patrick's hope was to put herself in position to try and make the fast nine for tomorrow. Two turns away. And checkered flag for Danica Patrick. And she will come up with the fifth fastest run so far of the 15 that have gone. Four-lap average, 227.610 miles an hour. For having been away as long as she was, that is quite an impressive run. Down to the pit lane, and Rick.
Now we're going to jump in with Sebastian Bourdais. That was a qualifying run that took a full year to complete. I hope you really understood the importance of that. What did it feel like to go across that line and get that checkered?
Oh, trust me, a lot of things went through my head the whole week, and particularly yesterday, you know, when you get back into the set of circumstances, you know, quality frame and everything. So it was not an easy day yesterday, but those boys did a great job. You know, that Sealmaster Honda number 18 was pretty strong. You know, we kind of almost did a repeat of yesterday. Conditions are a little tricky. It got a little hot. Track got over 100 degrees and ambient picked up. So always tough to kind of find your feet. Yesterday was overcast, you know, very low temperatures. So I'm pretty happy with the run, Maria.
All right, Sebastian Bourdais, a fast Honda out there today.
And you can only imagine what was going through his mind yesterday, this morning. It's only human. But conquered, and Bourdais third fastest. Here's Kyle Kaiser, the 22-year-old from Santa Clara, California, former Indy Lights Series champion, working his way up to the sport's top level, and here at the Indianapolis 500 for the very first time, just his fourth IndyCar start, period, and driving for Ricardo Juncos and Juncos Racing. So Kyle Kaiser looking to see if he can put four laps together that would get him into position to have a spot on the field. Now, Kyle, one of those guys in the danger lane as far as speeds, the no-toe speeds from Friday's practice were concerned. Out of 35 cars, he was only 33rd fastest.
But his warm-up speed at 225 and change was pretty good.
He's had a very methodical month of May, I'd like to call it, because, yes, he has not been all that quick, but then there are some people that come here that seem to really put their foot into it and overdrive the car. He's not done that. The one thing I do notice, if you watch his helmet right now, there is a little bit of buffeting there, Eddie. He sits a little higher in the car than some people, but when your helmet moves around like that, a little bit of buffeting, it makes it difficult to drive the car down to the turn. So it's interesting to see that. There is ways of going around to improve that, working with the helmet manufacturers and putting little gurney flaps and wickers on it, they call, but you want to be seated in that car, I always did anyways, as low as possible.
It would have been hard for you to sit up high. You're not that tall.
You know, as I was about ready to finish my sentence there previously, I thought that you'd have a comment with that. But anyways.
He's doing a really good job. Very tidy, not making any adjustments.
The full telemetry feed out from the car not working to us properly, but that tracking number is correct. So right now tracking 10th out of the 15 that have gone so far. Second lap, 226.089 for Kaiser. Remember the first time you came and qualified for the 500? What was it like,
Scott?
Oh,
yeah, absolutely I did. I don't think that I took a breath over four laps. Your heart rate is pounding so much, I thought that I'd have to loosen the seat belts because your heart's racing so hard. Remember that?
That's very true.
It's just amazing. And it's harder sitting in the line, and as soon as you get in the car and you're three cars away, then two cars away, and if there's any delay whatsoever for you to get out, you're going, come on, let's get going.
And these guys had a 2-hour and 20-minute rain delay to sit through. Yeah. Yeah.
I actually remember the balance more than I do the run. I had a very loose car, and I thought all cars were loose at Indy, so I had a hair-raising first Indy 500. This is a really good run. Really very, very tidy, very methodical. You can tell he's starting to lose a little bit of grip with his tires because he's going a little bit higher.
You know, when you watch the cars, and even when we have the onboard view where you can see the driver's hands on the wheels, right, the object's to turn the steering wheel as little as possible. So it can be hard to convey for people just how uncomfortable it can be driving one of these cars at this speed when it looks like it's stuck so well.
It does look like it, but it isn't. As Elio said earlier on, it's just your fingertips. I like to tell people you almost just squeeze your wrist on your right hand and it starts to turn the car into the turn. That's all you need to do on these cars.
That's a solid run. That's 225.934. That's 10th out of 16 for Kyle Kaiser. Very solid job for the rookie. Jan?
Nice job by Kyle Kaiser. And one of the things he had on his car are called underwing sidewalls. This, of course, is Alexander Rossi's car, and they're missing. All the cars I've seen come through the line have kind of a channel here on the side that give the car more downforce underneath. So Alexander Rossi, who declined to talk to us because he got into the car, they're taking a technical risk. They've taken off 150 pounds of downforce from the underside of the car to try and get just that little more speed. Rick?
Standing by with Danica Patrick. We were just talking about whether you had made any adjustments in the car between the earlier qualification setup and after the temperatures changed.
Well, I don't change things on the car. So if you mean in the cockpit, everything started where I wanted it to start, which was the same as yesterday. I mean, the balance was very similar the entire run. I didn't have the room to sort of chase it and keep freeing it up. Turn one was a little free just for a second in the middle, so I was like, you know what, it's good through two, good through three, good through four, do it again, one feels the same, good through two. So I just left it, so I don't know if I left some on the table that way, but it's interesting to know if, you know, the conditions are affecting the speed or not. I'm not fresh enough to go like, oh yeah, that's what it is, but you know, it's definitely hotter out now and the sun's beating down, so humidity's up probably. I'm sure at least it feels like it in my suit.
Let's talk about doing four laps at speed, because we've talked to a lot of drivers and talked about, you know, that's a really difficult thing to do. And now you're back at, you've been running all week.
Four laps is the shortest I've pretty much run the entire time I've been here back, so.
But all out.
Look, I've had many more laps than four in a row that feel horrible in traffic. So, yeah, I mean, when you're in qualifying trim, your car is going to be as balanced as you can get it. You know, you're by yourself. And the difference between, you know, getting a speed in practice and getting a speed in qualifying is you're getting it by less downforce in practice. But in race trim, you're getting it by horsepower, so with the boost and everything. So it kind of cancels out the speed a little bit. But, you know, everything was under control. I wish it would have been a little bit faster. I'd like to have been in the 228s, all of them. But, you know, I'm back. I feel good. The car's good. So we'll just see where we end up.
All right, there you go. Danica solidly in the field. Now she just has to find out whether she's in the Fast 9. Alan?
All right, Rick, thanks. Here is Max Chilton on the track and looking to gather some speed for this machine, the 27-year-old from the London area, back for his third 500. Remember a year ago, he led the race late. He led a lot of laps. He got off sequence on pit strategy. He got out there. He was racing for the win and wound up finishing in fourth position. Said, boy, if I knew then what I know now, the outcome might have been different. But again, until you go through that 500-mile journey, you don't know. There's so many things happen, and the conditions change so much. Well, here's Chilton back for another year, this time with a different team. Trevor Carlin's team with its first go at the Indianapolis 500.
Carlin has an incredible amount of success in Europe in all forms of racing. So I think if they bring that here, that'll make a big difference. And he's, as you said, he now knows what he didn't know last year. So you can expect him to have a very strong race if luck is on his side, because luck can change in a tenth of a second around here.
And he's one of the few drivers here that actually have F1 experience, just like you had. And you came from F1 into this series here. Obviously, lefts and rights and things of that nature, and then finding yourself on an oval. So he had quite a transition, just like you did when you arrived.
You want to avoid the rights when you're in the lefts.
Did you learn that the hard way?
I did.
Yes. Right is a really bad thought process around here. Yeah.
That's what I call right is wrong.
Right is very wrong.
When that happens on an oval.
This is another good run.
White flag here for Chilton. Three laps in the 225s. You see he's tracking about 11th. And we'll make that 11 out of 16.
Ooh. That was a bit high.
Yeah.
Everybody seems to be losing a little bit of grip in their tires on the fourth lap.
Well, and when the windsock does come up, because I am watching outside of our television booth, when the windsock does come up, it gives you a push going into two. Now, it may change by the time you look at it coming down the front stretch and gets yourself into one, and then sometimes it comes up and gives you a push into two, which can make you go high on the exit.
Checkered flag, and Max Chilton is 12th out of 17 now. Chilton in at a four-lap average of 225.666 miles an hour. Stefan Wilson and Matthias Laist are next. The oohs and ahs as we come back live to Indianapolis on bump day and watch Stefan Wilson, the 28-year-old originally from Sheffield, England, now living in the Denver, Colorado area. Taken is driven to save lives Honda for Andretti Autosport around the speedway. Stefan, of course, the brother of the late Justin Wilson, was supposed to make his second start in the Indianapolis 500 a year ago, was asked to give up his seat when Fernando Alonso became available, did so with a promise that he'd be in the race this year. Andretti Autosport making good on that promise, but for Stefan, he comes back to the speedway not having driven an IndyCar in 2 years. And trying to catch up to that is a big ask.
It's a very big ask. I sit here every year and see these drivers that commit to driving just Indy, and I wonder how they do it. There's just it's so quick, it's so complicated, it's just such a different series. I find this to be one of the most difficult races in the world, and I've done all of them.
And the most difficult racetrack in the world also. And it's funny because you and I are talking during a break one time that, you know, coming back and doing this yourself, I got back into a car after many years just last year with my son Michael to do a race up at Mosport in a BMW touring car. And a lot slower than this type of car. I went to the racetrack, which was my home track. I got out on the racetrack and I went around there. I was missing the apexes by 3 or 4 feet. It's just like your brain knows what it wants to do. It's just so difficult to do it. These guys are going this speed, 225, 230 plus miles an hour, and you have to have that left front tire hit that point as called the apex in the center of the turn every time, about the size of a sheet of an 8x10 paper. It's amazing what these guys can do.
He's doing it today.
Yeah. White flag here for Stefan Wilson. Four more corners to go. Got no testing. Didn't get to take part in any of the testing day that was held here a few weeks ago. His first laps in this car were when practice opened on Tuesday of this week, and had to do a refresher program that the Speedway requires for drivers who haven't driven here in a while, who already passed a rookie program earlier.
He should be very happy with this run.
To the checkered flag. And Stefan Wilson is through, and he will be 11th out of 18. 225.909, and I will agree with you, Eddie, he'll have a big smile on his face when we talk with him and he climbs from that car. Bump day today, our coverage continues on ABC starting at 4 Eastern time. Tomorrow, we have the qualifications to set the starting order for the 500. We'll be on ESPN3 and watch ESPN starting at 2:30 Eastern and the Fast 9 Shootout on ABC at 4 Eastern. Next weekend, the pre-race show for the Indianapolis 500 presented by Pennzoil, 11 a.m. Eastern, and the 102nd Indianapolis 500 telecast presented by Firestone starts at noon on ABC next Sunday. Need I say, we all can't wait. So another of the young rookies getting his first crack here at Indianapolis in the 500 is on the racetrack. Mateus Leist, the youngster out of Brazil, the 19-year-old, driving for AJ Foyt Racing, one of their ABC supply machines. He does have success on the Indianapolis Oval in his past. This was a year ago in the Freedom 100 for the Indy Lights Series. And the young man, tall, slender, big smile, big old mappa lettuce on his head, big personality, and...
When you say this, a big, big head of lettuce, I had to laugh at Tony Kanaan the other day because he said he has his helmet size is one size larger because he has all that hair.
And there's A.J. Foyt, the owner, and my point tying together Kanaan and Foyt and Leist was this is a team that has shown some pace here this week in practice.
Yes, and to be there, A.J. had to believe that they could get the job done.
Yeah.
He's a rookie. And he's been working a lot with the team, and they think very highly of him. And, of course, he has Tony Kanaan as a teammate who is phenomenal when it comes to closing a race if he's in the lead here at Indy. The way he won his 500 was the stuff of myths.
Yeah, remember he said on the radio, we're either going to win it or we're not going to finish.
That made me think of Babe Ruth when he pointed someplace, and that's where I'm going to hit it. And he did exactly what he said he was going to do.
So Leist on the green flag for the beginning of his four-lap journey around the racetrack. This team, another one of the Chevrolet teams that, again, has seemed to have had a little bit more grunt this week than Honda, in exact opposite of a storyline from what we saw here a year ago. Leist tracking fastest on this first lap so far, now losing a little bit of speed in turn three. We're comparing his run real-time against Elio Castroneves, the current provisional pole sitter.
Anything in the top 10 for this young man is a great result today.
Without question.
His main objective has got to be to get in the field and finish his first Indy 500. Oh, that's a little bit wide.
But didn't lift. So there's a young man that, after watching him at the Phoenix test earlier this year, I'll tell you what, I say that he's probably not going to lift very often.
Going fast is what he's about. Leist is, I mentioned, 19 years old, from Brazil. Had three wins in the Indy Lights last year with Carlin. We mentioned Trevor Carlin and all of his success fielding developmental teams around the world. A long list of drivers that have come to IndyCar from the British Formula 3 Championship. He won that a couple of years ago. Some other Brazilians who have won that title. Their names include Piquet Jr., Barrichello.
Oh, you're forgetting one.
And Senna.
Senna.
I wasn't forgetting him. I was saving.
You're just saving the best
I was
for
saving
last.
The best for last. Yes.
That is an impressive championship to win, and I'm sure that played heavily in Foyt's choosing him to come here. This is another very strong run.
So low below that white line, all the way down the apex of the turns. You watch his line, probably turning in a little earlier than Elio was, so he shallows the corners, I call it, gets a little low early, which forces you a little high sometimes on the exit.
He's not shy to use the whole track.
Right there.
Whoa. And some.
Oh, that's got to
happen. Every inch of the track.
Yeah, that's what I was just starting to say. You can see that starting to happen. And as a driver, if a car has a tendency to push or something like that, you start to turn it in a little earlier. You think that's safer, but you always have to contend
with the
exit.
But what we're seeing is the end result of something that started probably 200-300 yards earlier. You can't make an adjustment the last 50 yards to not hit a wall.
Checkered flag for Mateus Leist, and he'll be seventh. 227.441, the four-lap average speed in miles per hour. How close was it off of turn number two? Well, I was about a fraction of a second from yelling trouble. It was that close.
There was 2 inches left.
Plenty, right? Plenty. Maybe not.
Yeah.
Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway on bump day. And that driver just taking the green flag is Connor Daly, the hometowner, the 26-year-old from the Indianapolis area, looking to make the field for another Indy 500, what would be his fifth, driving an entry fielded together by Dale Coyne Racing and Tom Burns, local area businessman. If it looks familiar, the paint scheme, the United States Air Force Recruiting Command is one of the sponsors on the car. Doesn't that look like one of the U.S. Air Force Thunderbird planes flying down the track? pun intended.
It looks cool. And for young Connor, a boy that has really paid his dues throughout running not only in Europe but here in the United States. And I talked to him during the open test here, and he's a selling driver, as I'm going to call it, because he's out there on the phone during the week talking to prospective sponsors, as you see his father, Derek, on the right-hand side. Derek used to race against you, Eddie, in Formula One. And without a doubt, a driver with a lot of talent. I hope he gets into the show here. He was a little worried about that. But, Jan, you have more?
I do, and one of your favorites, Scott, Robert Wickens, of course, Canadian now, taking your first shot at qualifying for the Indy 500. Obviously, James, your teammate, didn't have a good run. Could you learn something from that that might help you?
Yeah, we've communicated, but you know, when you're here, everyone's gone through tech. You kind of have to run what you put in here. So we'll see how it goes. Hopefully, you know, it goes better than his. But so far this whole week, you know, my Lucas Oil crew has been doing a great job. Evernote Schmidt, Peterson Motorsports have been working hard. So hopefully we can try to get into the Fast 9 and play for fun tomorrow.
All right. So he's done the simulations, but now it's all for real, Alan.
All right, Jan, thanks. White flag for Connor Daly back there in bubble range.
Big drop the last two laps. His first one was a 2:24, and his last two laps have been a 2:22.
It is a very difficult thing to come here and put together a program, a short program they call it, an add-on car for a team, and they have struggled to find some speed out of this car. Not done yet, but given the rain delay that we had earlier today, the chances of getting another crack or two at it might be limited.
And expecting to find 3 miles an hour in the next few hours is a stretch.
That is the slowest of the drivers who've completed their runs, and the speeds fell all the way down to 2:21 on that fourth lap. So a 2:22 four-lap average for Connor Daly. Downstairs.
Yeah, we're here with Stefan Wilson. I can tell you, I was talking with Stefan this morning. You didn't have much of a smile on your face, but when you got out of the car, it came back. But what we really want to talk about is, what's it like to not having raced here, not having qualified here for 2 years and get back and do that again?
I mean, that's what makes it so tough, you know. You have 2 years to think about it. And then there's just so much on the line when we get in that car to do four laps. And you just know that it's kind of everything that you've worked for your whole life and your whole career. And, you know, if it doesn't go well, then it's really detrimental to your whole career and everything. So, you know, definitely as you get in, strapping in, you know what it's at stake, and you know how tough, how challenging it's going to be, because there's 35 drivers here, and they're all great. You know, they all deserve to be on the show. They're all solid drivers. And, you know, you've got to go out there and try and earn your spot.
Well, for now, he looks like he's comfortably in the show, but he was just saying a moment ago, you don't know what's going to happen at the end of the day.
Yep. But I think Stefan summed it all up well there. It's everything you've worked for. To not deliver can be very damaging. So here's Alexander Rossi on the track on his warm-up lap. Yes, he did win the Indianapolis 500's 100th running a couple of years ago, running on fumes, literally. Maybe we should have that Jackson Brown song behind this, running on empty, because he was when he coasted to the checkered flag. But he was the first one to complete the 500-mile distance, and he's been a force in this Verizon IndyCar Series season so far. Already a winner in the Long Beach race in April. And there is no question he will be a force in next Sunday's 500-mile race.
He didn't just win Long Beach. He qualified on pole, and he was the fastest car throughout the whole race.
Now, remember what Jan showed us earlier, the technical report he gave us, where this team has removed some of the aerodynamic underneath attachments to this car to try and remove some of the downforce from it, try and add a little bit of speed. Will it be enough?
Well, the thing that I think about there is the car starts to go off a little bit as the run goes through, talking about late lap two, lap three, lap four, when the tires start to go away on you a little bit. That's when you might notice it the most, when you have a little less downforce, Eddie, and the car starts to go across the road. You have to turn the steering wheel more, scrub off more speed, or possibly even lift, and your heart rate goes up.
When the professor said he took 150 pounds of downforce out of the car, that is an enormous amount. When you're tuning for qualifying for the 500, you're normally talking about 10 pounds of downforce and 2 pounds of drag. So that's a really big gamble. And right now, on this lap, it doesn't quite look like it's paying off what they're hoping for, but it is definitely a big gamble.
Rossi driving for Andretti Autosport. So much talk about Penske and Ganassi traditionally around Indianapolis, but Michael Andretti's team has won the 500 for the last two straight years and three of the last four. No reason.
Oh.
Wow. No reason to expect they won't be contenders come next Sunday.
Sorry, Alan. I saw how low he was in the center of the turn, and I went, before I got going, because I knew where that was headed.
And he had a wiggle turning into one. This is just lap three.
I'm going to look away from the monitor for a minute, okay? Can you just take over?
I don't know if taking all that downforce off is really
proof. That's what I said, lap three, lap four. So this is where you got to brave it.
White flag, one lap to go for Rossi.
Yeah, I got a feeling the other Andretti teams are going to put those pieces back on.
But if they've come through tech and they've taken them off, they can't.
Boy, he's close.
And he is the only car that I've seen thus far that has removed them. Every other car through the line has those sidewalls on.
Yeah, interesting.
I really believe that Rossi has not achieved his full potential in IndyCar yet. He continues to get better and better and better after every event.
Checkered flag, and Alexander Rossi finishes his four-lap run in 10th place.
He dropped a 2:24 the last lap.
Like you said, as you go on and on and on, the effect of that change was going to show up. So 226.212, the four-lap average for Alexander Rossi, 10th out of 21. Here is J.R. Hildebrand getting ready to head out onto the racetrack. Of course, Hildebrand will never be able to be separated from what almost was when leading the 500. He ran into the last corner, up on a lap car, got up into the marbles and hit the wall, and instead of winning the race was left to wonder what if, as Dan Weldon went by him driving to the finish line, and Weldon would go on to win the 500. You talk to JR about that this day, and he's got a great attitude and a great philosophy about it. Again, he was a rookie. What he knows now that he did not know then might have made the outcome of that completely different.
Might have. But he drove perfectly. I remember that weekend. He drove perfectly all the way through the race until that last corner. And that last corner in an Indy 500 at the end of the race is always filled with debris, and there is absolutely no grip up there. I lost a win there with Schechter. Schechter did exactly the same thing, but not very...
You lost it as a team owner.
As a team owner, it's the same thing. Yeah. It was my pocketbook.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, so, how many times does he bring that up? It just
must be... Well, listen, it's obviously left a scar.
It's a tricky corner at the end of the race.
So Hildebrand driving here for Dreyer and Reibold Racing, a second effort for them, a team that has been an Indianapolis 500-only effort, and with one car for the last few years, back with two this year. Hildebrand, the 30-year-old out of Sausalito, California, taking the green flag to begin his four-lap run. Let me remind you, while we watch JR get going, of a couple of things. First, he did have a little wall contact a couple of days ago with the right side of this car. It was repaired. He practiced yesterday with it. Also, have you noticed the skies have gotten a little dark? There is another blob of weather that's turned up that might become a problem here in the very short-term future.
Have the temperatures started to drop?
Yes, but not much. Just a couple degrees.
We're seeing a lot of variance between these runs, aren't we?
Well, I think we're seeing a lot of variance over here between turns on one end of the racetrack to the other end of the racetrack. That's what I start to see as a constant right now. And it's three and four that's giving people the most trouble, because that's where they're losing their time. So... You know, when I think about JR, I always think about speaking to him. When you speak to him, it's almost like you're getting a lesson in engineering, because you ask him about the car, and he just starts to really get into really in-depth information about what the car is doing. And I sometimes wonder whether he could think too much when he's on the racetrack about what the car needs from an engineering perspective.
Well, would you even have time to do that, running at these speeds or in a race?
No, I mean, yeah, you think about when you're going through there, like in turn one, and the thing, you know, you feel the back end of the car, and you think, oh, maybe that might need a little bit more rear rebound in the left rear, and you keep that in the back of your mind. So when you come in and talk to your engineer, and try and make some decisions, and I'm just wondering if maybe that's a bit too, he's got too much of that boy, because I feel like I learn something every time I speak to him, which is tremendous.
Well, he does have people who learn from him when he speaks. He does lecture at Stanford University. A guy who turned down the chance to go to MIT, pretty good school in itself, to pursue his racing career. And now coming down to take the white flag and one lap to go. Remember last year, running for Ed Carpenter Racing, he was running in fifth position coming to the last restart. And he was, or to one of the late restarts, and he was penalized for passing before the green flag and had to make a pass-through penalty, and he wound up finishing last on the lead lap in 16th place. But JR is one of those, as has shown us again and again. He knows how to get a race car around this speedway.
Just got to get that last little bit of the race done. Yep. Very talented.
Tracking just outside the fast nine, coming to the checkered flag here. And the four-lap average for J.R. Hildebrand will put him in 10th place, 226.499 miles per hour. Rick?
Well, we're down here with Alexander Rossi right now, 11th on the day. But it, looking at that run, it looked like you had your hands full the entire time.
Yeah, I'm just very glad that not Andretti Honda's in the show. That became the main priority after the first half of a lap. So we missed it, no doubt, but hopefully we'll get another shot at it this afternoon. We know there's plenty of performance for a Fast 9 car.
Sounds good. Alexander Rossi, once again, hoping for another run today.
Isn't that interesting? You go out there, and as you see some of that rain approaching us from the west, and you see where the speedway is located at the center of the bullseye with some of that rain, if you will.
What I liked about that interview is he got right to the point quickly and moved on and went and started heading back towards the engineers.
Just like he did with his run. After the first couple of corners, he knew,
let's get this over with. I got something else to do.
Just get it cleanly in the show and let's go.
Here we go. This is a big one.
What is something dragging
there? No, there's something on the track there. There's
it's out the right side. It was on the right side of the car.
This is Marco Andretti in the 98 car, new number this year. Marco looking to make his 13th start in the 500. Always seems to be at his best here. Yes. Now, I know you probably read in the newspapers Marco's name as being among the fastest in practice yesterday, but that was in the speeds in the draft. He has said, yes, but in the no-toe speeds, we weren't as good. Right, he was 12th fastest in the no-toe speeds from yesterday in qualification practice.
Well, the silver lining is that, and that is that there'll be a lot of towing in the race. So if your car is that quick, you're going to be in good shape for the race.
Green flag for Marco.
He does have a lot of affinity, as his whole family does, for this track.
Yes. It's the one thing that would mean the most, without question.
His dad could have won Indy a minimum of three times.
But, you know, I think I brought this up just a little while ago. It's time to change the narrative about Michael Andretti in Indianapolis, right? Yes, he might have not gotten the trophy as a driver he wanted to, but this race team that he's put together has come to dominate this race in these last several years.
The universe has a way of balancing out things like that. So he's been... You could say fortunate as a team owner and unfortunate as a driver, but if you want to win Indy, you have to beat his cars.
Yes. Three of the last four and the last two straight winners' trophies have resided at Andretti Autosport.
And some of them, like Rossi's win, was done on genius strategy. Done just on the spur of the moment. We have just this one card to play on fuel. Let's go for it. Well, and they executed it perfectly.
That was Brian Herta who executed that strategy, and Herta is executing the strategy on Marco Andretti's car.
And Rossi did what he was told to do. Let's see what Marco gets on his third lap.
226 flat for the second lap as you look at the recent winners, Hunter Ray, Rossi, and a year ago Takuma Sato, with that power move to get past Elio Castroneves with five laps to go.
I think Takuma might have learned the lesson that he had with earlier.
Back in 2012 when he crashed trying to pass Dario.
He was being too nice. You don't want to be too nice those last laps on the Indianapolis 500 when you have a chance to win. This is not a run that he's going to be very happy with.
White flag, one lap to go for Marco. His tracker has him, you see, outside of the top nine.
And you always talk about the weather. There's shadow all the way around the track now.
Track temperature has cooled off about 3 degrees in the last several minutes. That's not a ton. Enough to make a difference?
Yes.
Almost like the engineer's worst nightmare of a day, right? You set your car up for what you think it's going to be, and then you might catch the shadow, you might catch the sun. You might be the first car to run after a rain shower. Checkered flag for Marco Andretti. That one down in the 225. So the four-lap average, 226.154. It's 12th out of 23 cars. No fast nine for Marco, at least as of yet. Now, what was that we saw in the warm-up laps?
Yeah, just it's almost like there's some dust on the track or something of that nature, but certainly coming off the car itself, that is very strange.
That was on the right side. That's on the left side. Is he grinding something?
That's like something to do with...
I don't know. It's almost like something to do with the brakes. It seems like it's coming out of the...
Weird.
Yeah.
Maybe they had some.
Weird.
Maybe they had some trick thing they wanted to use for qualifying.
Well, I'm sure that they'll be looking at it because if there's something going on, maybe it slowed the car down. But you know that will be looked at by the team and also looked at by tech.
Yeah.
Everybody tries to take as much drag, mechanical and aerodynamic drag out of the car as they can. Who knows what that was? And I seriously doubt they'll tell us.
honest answer there. So as Marco comes in, Zach Veach has gone onto the racetrack, and we continue to watch the radar and the skies.
Yeah, he's shaking his head. He knows it's not exactly what he wanted.
I have found Veach very interesting to follow this year. Started off slowly, but every race he gets a little stronger and a little quicker.
Here's a young kid who worked his way up the ladder with great success, then suffered great setbacks, and has been rewarded for his perseverance and his talent with a 3-year contract with Andretti Autosport. This is the first of those 3 years to drive this car. Michael Andretti has said right from the outset, this is a learning year about how to be a full-time IndyCar driver for Zach Veach. But by year three, we're really going to see something out of this kid.
And having Michael as a team owner will help guide him through a lot of the ups and downs that inevitably will happen in a season.
Well, just the other drivers that are there, too. You think about all the experience, you know, the guys on the team have, including Ryan Hunter-Reay. And they all say that they get along with him very, very well. Great young man, works very hard, works out very hard. He's been through all the ladder system on the Mazda road to Indy and 13 wins through all that he's done. So he's proved himself at every level through all the competition. So I think that all he has to do now is start to get to the podium and then the center step here in IndyCar.
Let's check downstairs with Rick.
Yeah, we're standing by with Marco Andretti, and like you said, he was shaking his head when he got out of the car. And you were saying there's a lot more in this. Where is it, and how do you get it?
Well, balance. I mean, I knew lap one, we were way off in balance. I knew it was going to be a super long four laps. Had to chase it with cockpit tools, which is never fun. Super disappointed. I think there's speed in the actual car itself. We just need to balance it. That wasn't the car we practiced, though, and it's not the conditions. It's pretty far off. We got to figure out what happened there.
All right, on your warm-up lap, it almost looked like there was something around the car. Did you get any sense of that? We couldn't figure out if it was dust or maybe something on the track.
I was weaving on the back, you know.
Probably just shaking it up.
Well, it's something, yeah, that we do, but I don't know. No, I don't think it was like a issue like that. Otherwise, we would have had to wave off, but we need to get the balance right. I want to go back out. I'm not happy with that.
All right, sounds good. Marco's going to try and get back out there. In fact, when Marco was driving in, the first thing he said is, let's get back in line.
Now I gotta know why they're weaving down the straightaway. Do you have any idea on that, Scott?
I don't know, but I'd get them pulled over in 465, wouldn't it? By the state troopers.
All right, Veach's first lap was 226 and a half. Second lap, 226 flat. Third lap, 225 and a half here on the fourth lap to see where he'll slot in. You see, tracking 16th right now. Out of 22 that have completed their runs, just joining us, Oriel Servia has also did not complete his run earlier today. Serbia will be one hoping that the weather stays dry and they can get all the way through the qualification line, and people will start to get second opportunities out on the racetrack, because otherwise he's in jeopardy of not making the Indianapolis 500 without even a full four-lap run.
And by then, Alan, the track will be a lot faster.
Could be interesting. So the four laps, 225.8 for Zach Veach, 16th out of now 23. Well, he has been the class of the rookie class so far, although he's no ordinary rookie. Robert Wickens of Guelph, Ontario, has spent his last several years racing in Europe for Mercedes-Benz, is why I say he's no ordinary rookie. Came out in the season opener, the St. Petersburg Grand Prix, and was racing for the win on a late restart when Alexander Rossi had a go at the inside of him, and it worked out the worst for Wickens. He wound up in the barrier. Rossi continued on. Wickens has been strong almost every place he's been. He's had a chance to win not just that St. Pete race, but the Phoenix race. He was the leader on a late restart when Joseph Newgarden on fresher tires was able to get around him. Wickens has been solid so far this season. And now here he is at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway Oval for the very first time, looking to see if he can continue on what's been a tremendous start to his IndyCar career.
There haven't been any circuits, Scott, that he's been tripped up on. He was good on an oval, he's good on a road course.
You know, and I saw him during testing in the winter months down at Sebring, where everybody goes to the winter test program. And I got to tell you, the first day in the car, by later that afternoon, he was very impressive and going the same speed as everybody else. He obviously has a lot in his mind right now because, as we mentioned, his teammate, James Hinchcliffe, did not get much speed out of the car. And yes, you can get information from your teammates, as we know. But as has been reported, once your car is in that line to get out onto the racetrack, once it's been through tech, you cannot make any changes. So whatever he has, he's running.
Not without pulling it out of line and going back to tech. But at this point, with the weather around us and the clock ticking, you want to make sure you get your qualification attempt in
and done.
Yes. Then if the chance goes to go back out like Marco Andretti was talking, then you go back through and do what you want to do and try and get it through tech and back out to the grid.
There's an if attached to that. The weather's nasty.
Yes. So first lap for Wickens, 226.387. Yellow flag. Raindrops hitting one of the safety trucks in a corner of the speedway. And when you're doing 225 miles an hour with slick tires on the car, that's not something you want to drive through.
Those two things don't mix well.
Yeah. Well,
that's so
think about all the anticipation, right?
I know. That's what I'm thinking about right now.
Oh.
And the first lap is normally the hardest one to get off because the car's not warm, the tire's not warm. So he had that out of the way.
Yep.
And he was ready to finish his last three, and he gets stopped on his second.
Try to get into sequence, try to get smooth, and just to make sure you hit your points, and all of a sudden you're going, really? Really?
Well, we'll see how long, how heavy moisture might be. We'll wait and watch for a moment. Red flag out at Indianapolis.
Okay, maybe just a little sprinkle will dampen our activity For more than a century, the Indianapolis Motor Speedway has pushed man and machine to the edge.
Push hard. Yeah, well, now I'm going harder.
These drivers will take to this speedway alone.
That is a bad, fast-looking race car.
Oh, he hit the wall!
What a terrible crash!
Sebastian Bourdais lost control of the car.
Wow. That just shows you what happens when these cars come unglued to the track.
Who will cover the distance the quickest?
This is going to be close. Is it enough for the 500 pole?
You're going to be P1.
Now this is Indianapolis 500 qualifying.
The sun is back out at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. On bump day, the drama and tension of setting the 33 who will compete in next Sunday's Indianapolis 500-mile race heightened by two rain delays and now a compression of time for drivers to scramble to make sure they're in the 11 rows of three next weekend. We started at 11 a.m. An early runner was Elio Castroneves, currently the provisional pole sitter. His Penske teammate, Simon Pagenaud, also running. He is currently second. Then as James Hinchcliffe waited to run, a rain delay that spanned 2 hours and 16 minutes stopped the proceedings. We went back green again after those 2:21, and Sebastian Bourdais, involved in that terrible crash a year ago, posted the third quickest time. Also in that segment of qualifying, Danica Patrick went out, returning to the speedway for the first time in some time, and locked in four laps at an average speed of 227.610 miles an hour. Patrick sitting fifth on the provisional grid for now. It started raining again at 3:16 Eastern time. We are less than 10 minutes away from the resumption of qualifications. We have 11 cars yet to make their primary runs, and then a whole line of people waiting to try and make sure they don't get bumped out or to try and bump their way back in to the grid for the Indianapolis 500. Here's how they stand now. It's been a Chevrolet heavy day so far, but you can see of late some of the Hondas making it interesting. The manufacturer competition, certainly a big story on the day. The top nine get into the Fast Nine shootout tomorrow at this time here on ABC, but the big story is at the bottom of the grid, where there are 35 drivers competing for 33 starting spots. Oriel Servia has not yet made a qualification attempt. He had a bobble on his opening lap of his run earlier today, so he has not gone. He's waiting for the other 11 drivers to finish qualifying and hoping that weather stays away from us so he has a chance to try and be in the Indy 500 field. And with that, we say hello from the Speedway. Alan Bestwick with the 1998 winner, Eddie Cheever. And the Queen subject from north of the border still celebrating the royal wedding, two-time runner-up Scott Goodyear. Qualification day for a driver knowing there's bumping about to be had. What's it like?
It's tough. And the clock is ticking. There's not very much time left. You've got to get it all done. And we've had cars that thought they were going to go fast that went slow. And cars that didn't think they were going to be that fast that went fast. So right now, it's time to get out there and do it. And the more we wait, and the more cars run, the more people are going to be willing to risk. And the more risk you take, the more possibility you have of having an accident.
And we're doing risk with a car that not all the engineers and drivers know everything about, because we have this new Universal Aero Kit, which is new to both the Chevrolet and the Honda cars this year. So it's not like we have years of information. When the weather changes, we go into our computer and look at this information and go, this is what we'll do. Hey, driver, go out there and put your foot on it. You're good for it. Right now, we're sort of learning, and everybody is like, well, I don't like going 230 miles an hour like that. You can. But right now, there's a lot of unknowns for a lot of these drivers and engineers. But still, as a driver, when you slide in the cockpit, you have to have the confidence that when the engineer says it's good, you have to keep your foot flat in the gas in turn one.
Well, add to the anxiety being the first driver to go after a break for weather. Robert Wickens had just begun his qualification attempt when that last rain shower started to fall. Well, he is there in line. He's been given the 1 minute to go signal where they'll be firing him up in less than a minute and sending him out onto the racetrack to try and secure a spot in his very first Indianapolis 500-mile race. Wickens from Ontario has spent the last few years being a factory driver for Mercedes over in Europe in the German Touring Car Series. He is no ordinary rookie, and he has a pretty sporty car that has shown itself to be top 10 fast in practice yesterday. Here are the rules for today. Everyone is guaranteed one four-lap attempt. After that, the bumping begins. 35 cars here, the fastest 33 make the race. They sleep on it overnight, wipe out all the times, and then start qualifying one more time tomorrow in reverse order of their speeds today to determine their actual place on the grid for next Sunday's Indianapolis 500-mile race. Before we get to the fast nine for tomorrow, the story, though, is about making the field for today. And for some drivers, like Wickens, trying to make that fast nine, trying to be in those first three rows of the grid. He's had a very good car in practice.
A good car in practice, but now he's running by himself. When we talk about practice, we talk about other cars on the racetrack, and you get an aerodynamic benefit from the car, even that you can see up ahead of you, punching a bit of a hole in the air for you. So now here's a true testament to what your cars have available to you when you're qualifying by yourself. Now, for Wickens, unfortunately, his teammate James Hinchcliffe did not show that much speed. They'd like to make some changes on the car, but by the rules, once your car is in the qualifying line, you can no longer make a change. So he's going to go out there and run and hope the weather conditions, which play a huge part into this, might help improve his speed. But he's not seen speed yet today.
So let me run some math by you. It takes about 6 minutes for a car to make its qualification run. We have 11 cars yet to get their first opportunity to qualify. We start now. That's going to take us to about 5:15 Eastern time. The qualification session ends at 5:50 Eastern time. So that's going to leave us about 35 minutes for people to line up and try and bump their way back in or keep themselves from getting knocked out of the 500 field. How they go about doing that gets a little more in-depth. We'll talk about that when we get to that point. First, though, Wickens is on the track for the first of his two warm-up laps. So let's talk about conditions, mindset, so on. You've been out there. You got basically a lap in the books earlier before it rained. Had to stop because of the moisture. They got to cool down your car, put a fresh set of tires on it. Now you're back at the head of the line, and you go out knowing track conditions have changed a little bit. You see those track temperature numbers. How important are they, and how do they affect what the driver knows about what his car is going to do?
No driver likes being the first driver to go on an open track after it had been raining and it had dried out. That's the first point. The second point is, with the car they had been running up till last year for many years, all the engineers knew exactly how to prepare the car for any given temperature. With these new cars, they don't. And lots of drivers have come in scratching their heads saying, well, I thought I was going to have the car do one thing and it did another. So it's a difficult situation that he's in, and he's got to put four good laps in right now.
Jan Beekes is on the pit lane for us today. Jan?
And you mentioned that there are no changes allowed for a car that is called off of qualifying. Of course, Robert Wickens does have a fresh set of Firestone tires, and they're allowed to fuel the car back up. One other change they may make if they choose is the front wing. But I'll tell you, he had a 20 to 30 minute debrief with his engineers at his timing stand, a whole army of engineers, because they have one timed lap of data, trying to look to see how can they squeeze a little bit more, knowing that he's had one in the books.
Yeah, the real-time data that comes off these race cars back to the timing stands and the engineers is phenomenal. All kinds of readouts for them. And as Jan said, crunching the numbers, trying to see what it might mean. The tracker you're looking at, both the yellow number on the sliding ruler and in the top left corner of the graphic at the bottom of the screen, shows his actual position comparing real-time this run against the fastest car, which was Elio Castroneves much earlier today. You don't expect to see that throttle readout move much because the foot should be flat all the way to the floor around here in these Indy cars.
Now that 226, I was pleased to see, because his warm-up lap, 216, we're generally seeing warm-up laps at 219 to 223, but could be the fact that he was the first guy out after a rain delay. It just takes a little bit more mindset to keep yourself believing that the track is okay.
I mean, you have to convince yourself when you're qualifying that you're not going to take your foot off the throttle. And it sounds very easy sitting here in a TV booth, but when you're out there, it's difficult, especially when you don't know what the conditions are. Now he's processed all that information, so he is ready. You can tell by his lines that he's comfortable in the car. He's running a Honda, which today has not been the fastest engine to date. And he is, I think, on a good run right now.
It's not that far off. Some of the later cars to run, like Sebastian Bourdais, third fastest, a lot closer
in
to
a
the
Honda.
Two Penske Chevys that ran earlier. So might not be as much of a gap as it appeared earlier in the day between the two makes. We'll have to see. Wickens right now, two laps, averaging 226.1. That would put him right around in 12th position as he comes down here for the third of his four laps to be completed. White flag is up and one lap to go.
Now, as the drivers run continuous laps here, the car changes each and every lap. You see them getting a little close to the wall, making a bit of a correction there, but they have what they call cockpit tools inside the car. They can change the handling of the car as they go, and experienced drivers will know what to do over this four-lap run. This is the first time that Robert Wickens has actually qualified here at Indianapolis, so a big learning curve for Wickens this time.
A big learning curve, but he's a lot faster than his teammate Hinchcliffe was, who did only 224.7.
Only 224 miles an hour. Checkered flag, Robert Wickens is across. Wickens will slot in. We'll check on his numbers when we come back.
Day one of Indianapolis 500 qualifying on ABC is brought to you by Firestone. Whatever you drive, drive a Firestone.
Live on Bump Day at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, 24-year-old Gabby Chavez. Colombian now living here in Indianapolis, out on the third of his four time laps, driving for Harding Racing, local Indianapolis businessman. Mike Harding in charge of this team. They started a year ago, had a top 10 finish in the 500. Now the former series and 500 rookie of the year is taking the white flag for one more lap around. Robert Wickens, after his four-lap runs a while ago, we apologize for the technical difficulties that gave us the hiccup. He was 14th fastest in the six car. And here is Chavez trying to see where he might slot in. Right now, right in that same range as Wickens with that 225.9 average.
Gabby Chavez, I really rate him very high. A very talented driver, works very hard on his craft. Everybody in his team really respects him. He's got a great driver coach in Al Unser Jr. Al tells me that he is very, very talented. And he really burst on the scene the year that he was with Brian Hurd. I remember Brian telling me that this driver has a lot of talent.
Checkered flag for Chavez and his four-lap average, 225.808 miles an hour. That'll put him 17th on the grid for the moment. Down to Rick DeBruhl.
Yeah, standing by with Robert Wickens, who was the first guy to go out. You've had quite the rookie experience. I mean, from rain delays to an aborted attempt, and you really weren't happy with that one. Explain why.
I mean, I think we lost some speed overnight, which is always frustrating. You know, yesterday and Fast Friday, we could kind of always run in the mid-227s or low-227s, and now we can't even make it there. So we have some work to do. But, no, I mean, I think that rain delay couldn't have come at a worse time. I mean, got the car all hot and everything, did one-time lap and then stopped, and then, you know, it rained, but it's not cold outside, so everything heat soaked, and then we tried to go out, and the engine's not making good power because it's just hot. So, you know, we did what we could, but I feel like I, you know, didn't get a fair chance on that one.
Well, you're solidly in the field, but are you confident there's more speed in it for qualifying tomorrow, for getting your location on the grid?
I know there's more speed in it. It's just frustrating because I honestly think we had a good shot at Fast 9 today. And I mean, if we try again, we try again, but I mean, it just sucks because I think if we got a fair crack, we could have been Fast 9.
All right, once again, Robert Wickens looks like he's solidly in the field, just not in the top 9 like he wanted to be.
When I was talking to Chip Ganassi this morning before practice started, he talked about the heat soak, how close the cars and the engines are, and how just one cycle that you don't get the car to cool off can create a problem in performance. And it seems like that could be the reason why they were not as fast as he was hoping to be. These cars are very temperamental, and the track is very temperamental. Sometimes both ends just don't meet, and the car doesn't do what you expect it to do. And it is very frustrating.
Green flag for Sage Karam, back for another go at the Indianapolis 500. The 23-year-old from Nazareth, Pennsylvania, driving for Dreyer and Reinbold Racing, an Indianapolis 500-only team for now. And Karam has been with them now a couple of different times, four times to be specific, his fifth Indy 500 race. Remember when he started back in 31st and raced all the way up to a top 10 finish in his first go here? He's not had as much luck in the last few years, but back again for another try.
Some drivers are just comfortable with the speed in the Indianapolis 500, and he is one of them. From the moment he got here, speed did not seem to bother him.
And you think of somebody from our era, Eddie, when we drove, Ari Leyendijk, for instance, you know, coming out of Europe and coming over to ovals and did a tremendous job. A driver that drove for you with Thomas Schechter, I think, yeah. Another driver that just ultimately has super speed. And Sage Karam is another driver, young driver, that reminds me exactly of that, that some tracks just suit certain drivers, and he seems very comfortable with high-speed tracks.
I totally agree.
231 miles an hour into the corner.
Car looks freed up. Very important he stays consistent throughout the run. A lot of cars have dropped off the last two laps.
Second lap for Karam is faster than his first one was. Haven't seen that much at all today. 225.7 to 226.3.
And so by a big gap. So as he gets a little high there on the exit of two, remember, we do get a bit of a tailwind occasionally in two, although the windsock is not showing that big. There's much of a wind out there right now. That all these drivers have to make small little adjustments to account for the wind, if there is any, and then they do have the opportunity inside the cockpit to do work with the tools. We call them driver aids, changing the roll bar on the car, and also a weight jacker, which changes the weight amongst the four wheels, can change the handling for these drivers as they are on track.
Third lap is another 226.
That's solid, 226.204.
He's using every bit of the track.
Yeah. 226.1 is going to slot him in around 13th as we navigate these final couple of corners with Sage Karam. Checkered flag in the air. And Karam finishes his four-lap trip at 226.065 miles an hour, 14th on the grid for now. And that leaves us with eight drivers yet to go before the bumping begins, including Will Power for powerful Team Penske and Joseph Newgarden, last year's series champ. Working the third of his four laps of qualifications, Carlos Munoz, the former 500 Rookie of the Year. Just a spectacular debut here at the Speedway in 2013. This year, back with Andretti Autosport as he takes the white flag for one race only, this race. But back with a team and at a track where he's done so well.
We were talking about drivers that are just comfortable here. Well, he is at the top of that list. I remember watching him the first year he came here, and he kept flirting with the grass inside of turn one every lap and got away with it every time. Incredibly fast hands. Very consistent run. Every lap above 226.
Average is 226.6 right now. That's going to put him just outside of the fast nine. Checkered flag is up, and Carlos Munoz has completed his four laps here at the Speedway. 226.600. He will be 10th overall out of 27 drivers that have been on the Speedway. Let's check down with Jan.
And Ed Carpenter, of course, owner driver with a very fast car and a fast team. You look up at the pylon, two of your cars are already in the top nine. Both Spencer Pigot and Danica Patrick. Got to feel pretty confident for your run here.
Yeah, it definitely makes me feel confident. Yeah, I think, you know, sitting around waiting, any driver that's been here before can tell you sitting around and waiting is the worst part. So really just ready to go out. The conditions have changed a lot, but, you know, I've got two Penske cars who are good competition going right in front of me, so I'll get somewhat of a feel from the track from them, I think. And other than that, you just have to rely on the work we put in all week, and especially yesterday, and my teammates. But hopefully we can put all three in the fast nine.
All right, awesome. That would be quite an accomplishment for Ed Carpenter Racing if they, in fact, could get three in the top nine.
Well, they've got a couple of stout competitors to try and challenge for those spots. He mentioned the Penske cars. Here's one of them, last year's Verizon IndyCar Series champion, Joseph Newgarden, the driver from Nashville, who driving for Ed Carpenter a couple of years ago in 2016, qualified in the middle of the front row and had a top three finish. Now for the powerful Penske organization, they have been fast from the beginning of practice on Tuesday of this week. And right now, the top two drivers in the qualification results are the two Penske cars that have run already, with two yet to go.
Don't be shocked if this young man is right up at the front. Phenomenally talented and extremely aggressive.
Nashville, Tennessee, being just about 5 hours away. He started his karting career just here on the outside of Indianapolis at Newcastle Motorsport Park, which is owned and operated by an ex-IndyCar driver, Mark Dismore, and one of the nicest karting facilities in North America. His family would take the run up here every weekend so Joseph could run against the top talent in karting in the country. And everybody that's races karts knows that Joseph ran there, cut his teeth there. Connor Daly was there at the same time as he's under green. 226 guys as a warm-up speed. That's pretty darn high.
Yeah, sure is. So when you drive for Team Penske, your focus on the year is not only to win championships and win races, but more than anything else, to win the Indianapolis 500. Joseph joined the Penske team last year when they were kind of caught up in the middle of being on the wrong end of the manufacturer competition. This year, Penske has been strong every race, every week. Joseph Newgarden already this season has a couple of wins. And now here in Indianapolis, as team president Tim Sindrick looks on, Newgarden's strategist, it would not surprise me in the least to see a Penske sweep of the front row for the 500. That's how strong they've been so far this week.
They do seem to have an advantage over everybody else in understanding this new car. But definitely the magic that they've had this year, a lot of it can rest in the lap of Chevrolet. They've really come out with some good engines this year.
And when you talk to Joseph, he will tell you that he was nervous going to drive for Penske last year.
Yes.
Remember, we had that conversation with Kyle Moyer that as soon as he joined the team, every time he'd come over, he was always in his track gear that he was supposed to wear on race weekends when he was showing up at the shop during the week. And finally they said, hey, you can relax a little bit. You don't have to be so buttoned up here during the shop time. So you could tell he was a guy that wanted to make a great first impression, but he works very diligently, not only in the gym, but the engineers say that he's back there looking at all the data, works hard, and success has come his way very quickly with Team Penske.
And there's no question he has become the leader of Team Penske with his championship last year, his strong start to this year. And to cement that spot, a win at Indianapolis, giving the captain a 17th owner's trophy as a winner, would do a lot.
But right now, the Penske driver that's sitting at the top of the list is Castro Neves, and it looks like Joseph is not going to be able to jump ahead of him or Pagano.
Tracking third at the moment, coming off of turn number two, half a lap to go for Newgarden. So smooth. It's so fast.
It looks so smooth until something goes wrong.
That's right.
Yeah. I was going to say, it looks slow until you sit in the seat. You've got to go do this.
Checkered flag. And Joseph Newgarden clocks in, fading a little bit on that last lap. The four-lap average, 228.049. That'll put Joseph in fifth position, but in good stead to try and make the fast nine for tomorrow's qualification day. Next Sunday, a great day of racing. We start on ESPN at 9.05 a.m. Eastern with the Formula One Monaco Grand Prix, one of the highlights of the Formula One Grand Prix World Championship season. Then here at Indianapolis, our pre-race show presented by Pennzoil at 11 a.m. Eastern time here on ABC, and the 102nd running of the Indianapolis 500 presented by Firestone here on ABC at 12 noon Eastern time. I've seen nothing in the race practices throughout the course of this week to lead me to believe that next Sunday's race is going to be anything less than the spectacular show it's been for the last several years. It might look a little different tactically, but the field is very, very close together, and I think it's going to be a really competitive race. Here is Will Power with the fourth of Roger Penske's Rockets. The 3 weeks of competition here at Indianapolis began last weekend. Week ago today on the Speedway's road course when Power and Robert Wickens went wheel to wheel in a great fight for the race lead. Power winning pole, getting out front in a segment, falling behind in the second segment, getting around Wickens in the third segment and pulling away to score the victory. The 200th IndyCar win for Roger Penske. And what a day it was to start off his Indianapolis 500 bid.
When Power is on, he's hard to beat. And he seems to have carried a lot of that confidence from that win through all the practice sessions that we've had here. I'm happy to see Castro Neves at the top, but I think this might be the one driver that can get his car just that little bit ahead of Castroneves.
Well, the goal right now is to be in the top nine, which we fully expect Will Power to be driving for Penske, because as we know, tomorrow on ABC, it's the rerun for the top nine in the pole position. So Will, if there's any problems with the car whatsoever, he will not extend himself. He'll make sure that he's comfortably in the top nine, get back and tune it up for tomorrow's shootout for the pole.
Jan?
And I agree, Scott, and that is that he has the confidence that Eddie mentioned coming into this from a driver perspective, but he and his engineer, David Faustino, have a lot of confidence, and as you've mentioned, the fastest in the no-toe speeds in practice. He knows that he has something in the bag. The engineering team knows they have something in the bag, so they can, in some degree, be a touch more conservative, knowing they just need to hit the top nine here.
Talking to Will Power earlier this week, you know, everybody came here trying to figure out this new for 2018 model IndyCar. And Will talked about how his team found the envelope early in the week and in their testing. They found the envelope they wanted the car to be in, to be fast and to be comfortable and to be reliable. And ever since then, it seems like every time you talk to Will, the answer's kind of, yeah, smooth sailing, right where we want to be. Compared to other people who talk about the ups and downs of the week in Indianapolis. One day you're good, the next day you're not so good. Every time I've talked to Will, we're good. We're right where we want to be.
Oh, he's not going to be happy with this run. It's a 227.9.
But again, just needs to be in the top nine to have a shot at the pole tomorrow.
Absolutely. But today, the fastest is Castroneves.
Classic lines by Will Power, almost like Rick Mears' lines when I watch him run. Rick Mears running for Penske and won four Indianapolis 500s. Used to call him the Rocket Man, but they have him on staff as a driver coach for all these drivers here. The drivers will tell you that what great deal to go back into the transporter and speak to a guy like Rick Mears or sit down and have dinner with him. The wealth of knowledge that Rick gives along to all the drivers that come along in Team Penske, and he doesn't choose. It's open to everybody. Running here in Indianapolis, you've got a wealth of information by nobody better.
How about Castroneves having him as his spotter? I mean, Rick Mears as your spotter. I said that before. I think that almost should be considered illegal because it's just that's too big of an advantage. A great team, amazing team. What Penske has managed to do over the years is incredible.
White flag up for Will Power. One more lap to go. Power faster on his second lap than his first, and even faster on his third lap. That was the pattern that Castroneves put up way earlier on in this qualification session. You see, though, Will still tracking fifth fastest real time against the leader, Castroneves. Can he jump up from that third in this final corner and run down to the checkered flag? Going to be a real solid run for Will Power. Team Penske, 1, 2, 3, and 6 for the moment. Will Power, third fastest with a four-lap average of 228.194 miles an hour. Rick?
Well, standing here with Joseph Newgarden, and you called it as you were watching Will Power. You said, oh, he's going to go fast this last lap. That's exactly what he did. But let's talk about your run. Were you happy with it?
Yeah, it was a good run. Last lap wasn't good, so you hate to finish on that, but wasn't terrible. I mean, it was still a decent run for us. We just wish we could have maximized that last lap a little bit better, but the Verizon car's been quick. I think the track conditions slowed up a little bit with humidity. After all that rain, it's gotten really humid, and that kind of slows our cars down. So hopefully it's enough to hold. If it's not, then it's not meant to be, but I think we got a little more speed in our car.
So let's talk about that last lap. Was it something you did? Was it just the conditions? What was a little slower?
My line was a little bit off in two, and I pushed up. So I had to correct, and I lifted just a touch to correct it because I didn't want it to be a bigger moment. So, you know, that those fractions deals, they can hurt you here at Indy.
All right, Joseph Newgarden now just has to sit and watch and figure out if he's going to be in the top nine.
All right, Rick, thanks. So Tony Kanaan blasts out onto the speedway to begin his qualification run. Kanaan, one of the former winners in this race, entered 2013. What a restart driving that 11 car. He was not going to be denied as he forced his way to the front. Wound up winning the race that finished under caution and the popular Brazilian, now living here in Indianapolis, saw his chance to sip the milk and kiss the bricks at Indianapolis. Now you pair up a former Indy 500 winner with A.J. Foyt, the four-time winning driver and two-time winning owner of this 500-mile race. And what you've gotten so far this week has been a very fast race car.
And Kanaan is very confident in the team. He's very confident in the car. And Foyt is convinced that they have a good shot at this. I think that's a very volatile mix between the two of them. And if they can aim it the right way, it will surprise a lot of people. But if it's a shootout in the end, and Kanaan is in that group of four, my money's on him.
I was going to say the same thing. You know, you expect a lot of Tony Kanaan qualifying. He generally delivers if the car has the ability. But you're right, Eddie. If it comes down to the end, there's a guy that will be the best on a restart, pass more cars in a restart, will be more hunger. And he's still at the age of 43, where he seems like he's driving like a 23-year-old.
And he's got a young guy breathing down his neck inside of his team, which keeps him honest. So there he is, the man himself, A.J. Foyt.
Representative of the team must hold that green flag up when the car's coming to take the green to signal to IndyCar officials they want to go on with their qualifying run, not wave it off. So A.J. there, and Tony is on the clock. In the no-toe speeds, the IndyCar timing and scoring system having the ability to separate out cars that are getting assistance from the draft with cars that are out there by themselves. Tony Kanaan had the ninth best lap yesterday in the Fast Friday practice.
That's what he's running now, ninth. He's fallen back a little bit to 11th.
Warm-up speed of 2:18. Would like to see that a little bit higher. We'll see what the delta is, this big spread. Pretty darn good, guys. 2:27. This is a point where you now have one lap underneath your belt, Eddie, that you and I have talked about. We've lived it so many times. You know what the car is going to do. Do you make slight adjustments to your driving line? We heard Joseph Newgarden talking about that just a little bit. Some adjustments inside the cockpit that the driver is able to do. Tuning the suspension, the handling of the car.
Your number one priority is to do the least amount of damage that you can with the steering wheel. Every time you put too much in and start moving the steering wheel around, you're scrubbing off speed. You have to be as smooth as you can. But these cars, when you're going down the straightaway, if you were to leave, just loosen your grip on the steering wheel, it will turn naturally to the left. So you've got to try to almost hold it up in the straightaway.
Designed to do that by the chassis settings,
by the chassis, the tire,
the difference in the size of the tires, left side to right side, and so on.
Which is all to help the car turn around the turn. Remember, only 9 degrees of banking here, and you're going in these turns at 230 plus miles an hour. So cars, yes, are set up to do that way.
His second lap was a little bit faster, 227.7.
Third lap consistent, but a tick slower, 227.6. Right now, Kanaan tracking right on the backside of that fast nine, where his teammate, Matthias Laist, sits in ninth position.
Beautiful lines, very classic. Sweeps up to the wall going into the turn, like in turn three here. Reminds me of Rick Mears. Opens the arc.
One more corner.
Checkered flag for Tony Kanaan. And he will bump his teammate out of the fast nine and slot in the number nine position. Four cars to go before we get into the thick of people trying to go again. One of those with a shot, we think, at being fastest. The local kid who literally grew up here at the Speedway, Ed Carpenter, coming up after this message and a word from your ABC station.
Indy 500, Sunday, May 27th on ABC.
Back live at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway on Bump Day, watching Pippa Mann. Originally from England, now from the United States, former winner in the Indy Lights Series, on the road up to the Verizon IndyCar Series, looking to make the field for the 500 for what would be the seventh time. Pippa, when we spoke with her yesterday, really
yes,
stressed, because they have struggled to find some speed from this car, and they know that they're, you know, where they are in the qualifying line and the bumping process and so on. If you haven't found the speed by the time you get to the end of Friday night, it's going to be really hard to cook something up overnight. So she is riding the bubble here. You see 29th right now with just a few cars left to go before people will begin re-qualifying to try and go faster than she is.
We cannot know anything about her car from here other than the line she's taking, but I've been staring at that throttle pattern. She has not lifted her foot off the throttle one iota, so she's driving it as fast as it can go.
Checkered flag is up for Pippa Mann. The four-lap average, 224.360. That is 30th out of 31 that have gone, with just a few more left to go. And then the requalifications begin. Tough spot right on the bubble for Pippa Mann. Earlier, Rick DeBruhl spoke with Will Power.
Well, Will Power, you did something today that no one else seems to be able to do. You went faster every lap. How did you do that?
I think the balance just came in as the run went on. Obviously, fuel gets a little bit lighter too. So, yeah, I think other cars are going away. I think we have a good, solid balance car, so that's why it was going faster. But it's obviously a very different condition to the early runners, so hopefully we have a shot at pole tomorrow. But yeah, I think we're solidly in the nine, so I'm happy with that.
All right, Will Power, no plan to make a second run today, so hopefully that time will stand and nothing strange will happen at the very end of the day.
Yeah, I would think no plans to make another run, certainly. So three cars left to go. Takuma Sato, something being attended to on his car at the very head of the qualification line. The transponder that apparently records the timing and scoring is not doing what it's supposed to do. So that is why Sato is still sitting there. And moments are ticking away from some others who might wish to get out and try and re-qualify later on.
I wonder how much time they're allowed to sit and work on that before they make the move out of line.
Well, that becomes a thing where that, if it's the transponder, that's not a team problem.
Right.
So that's not necessarily under the firm rules of 1 minute and then you go. So
here he goes.
Yep.
Solve the problem. This team has had a very hard month of May.
Yes. So last year's winner getting fastened in, set to go. Heads out onto the racetrack. You know, old sayings become old sayings because there's a good bit of truth in them. You have to lose one to learn how to win one. This was Sato in the blue and white car trying to pass Dario Franchitti for the win in 2012. It did not stick.
And that they just slightly touched and Franchitti was able to continue on.
It
was amazing.
Well, last year, racing for the win in the closing laps with Elio Castroneves. And this time, instead of being the car on the inside, he took the outside lane. It stuck, and he was able to hold on to score a massively popular win. Sato returning to his home country of Japan as a conquering hero. The BorgWarner Trophy making a travel across the Pacific. And now here is Taku back, this time with Rahal Letterman-Lanigan Racing this year. He won it for Andretti Autosport a year ago. And back looking to see if he can become the first back-to-back winner of the Indianapolis 500 since, of all things, Dario Franchitti went back-to-back.
I've met and driven against and seen a lot of drivers over the past 35 years. I can truly say there's not many that are fearless, but this guy is one of them.
I know I got that wrong, but I'm looking for the name in my notes, and I'm having one of those moments, so forgive me. Elio. It was Elio that was the last to go back-to-back. Yeah.
There you go.
Don't try this at home. I'm a trained professional. So, the Rahal Letterman-Lanigan team, Graham Rahal right now, sits in 26th out of 31 that have run. They're also fielding the car for Oriol Servia in conjunction with another sports car racing team, Scuderia Corsa. They haven't completed a qualifying run, had to give up on his after a very difficult entry to turn one on his green flag lap. So here's Sato now, out there looking to see what he can do, and so far showing around mid-pack, which is pretty good for where they've been today.
Which is a vast improvement to where they were before.
Yeah.
When they interviewed Rahal, he was devastated after his run. He just looked like I don't know what else we can do. I'm going as fast as I can. And when that happens, that last day, you start grasping at straws. But obviously, this... Oh,
Whew, man.
But he's not lifting.
That's Sato. Fearless. He'll do that again and again. Just watch.
I take it from... Now, what you can't see, folks, in the booth is when that is happening and he's going, oh, his hands are up over his head. He's leaning back away from the screen like he's going to hit the screen or something. I take it you've hit a wall here before a time or two. That
I've knocked that wall in turn one out of position.
Leads you to have that natural reaction.
Well, the difference now when you see him go through turn one like you just did there, as the sun starts to hide itself behind the grandstands, you are driving into turn one at 230 miles an hour, driving into a shadow on the racetrack.
Had to lift.
Yeah, that lift is going to cost him badly. See all those small adjustments in the steering wheel? At that speed, those are big adjustments.
That's not just the car fighting against him. That's
him keeping it straight.
Yeah, dropped out to 224.1 on that lap with that momentary lift in turn two. Here he comes to that spot on the track again.
And remember, these cars do not have power steering or power brakes, so he's physically working that wheel. As tough as it is, Eddie, you and I have experienced it. Very difficult to do, a lot of feel for it, but then also very tough to turn.
I'm worn out just watching this run.
Well, he got through it, and he should not be too terribly close to the bump line, but 26th. Pushing Graham Rahal back to 27th. Remember, 35 cars for 33 spots. Tonight on ESPN, Game 3 of the NBA Eastern Conference Finals. The Boston Celtics and Cleveland Cavaliers. Celtics winning the first two in Boston. Tonight they're in Cleveland, though. We'll check it out. Starting at 7:30 Eastern with NBA Countdown. And, of course, it's also available on the ESPN app. Can King James lead the Cavs to a home court rally? Next Sunday in the Indianapolis 500, the pace car driver will be Victor Oladipo of the Indiana Pacers. A lot of folks excited about that here in town. Charlie Kimball, second to last car to get his initial qualification attempt. And when the next car, Ed Carpenter, finishes his run, then it opens up an interesting situation on pit road. There are two lanes that an owner can choose to put his car into for qualification. They call the fast lane and the not-so-fast lane, in my opinion. And what's fast is how quickly you get on the racetrack. When you go in this lane one, you have withdrawn your qualifying time. You have no time to fall back on. And you're going out to try and set one. If you go to lane two, and there's nobody in lane one, then you go out on the racetrack and still save your time that you set before, and you're just trying to better it with no consequence. But we've got enough people that are going to jump into that priority lane that I'm not sure how many of those people looking to better their time are actually going to get a shot. We've already got Oriel Servia in the priority lane. Remember, we had the problem on his qualifying run earlier. Connor Daly has already signed the form for his team to withdraw their time, looking like he's going to be outside the top 33. So he's in that lane as well in that 17 car. And everybody else is in that outside line saying, yeah, we'll keep our time. But if things start to happen, you might see a couple of other cars jump over it in the fast lane, because getting on the track with no time may be better than being bumped out with a time that's not fast enough.
And the farther the clock flows along, the more chaotic it will become.
Chaotic's a good word. Charlie Kimball from California. His family losing significant portion of their avocado orchard business in the Thomas Fire. So terrible last year. Charlie out there with his family as they fought to save their home, which they were not successful at. Spent a good bit of time rebuilding with them in the offseason. Said it's going to take a decade for the orchard to recover its production levels from before the fire. And that's just one family story of so many that were so devastated by those fires. Charlie here racing not only for them, but as always representing those who have diabetes. And has had some really good success in this Indianapolis 500-mile race, though driving for a new team this year. Kimball's best finish in this race was third in 2015.
Very technical, very methodical in how he approaches the race. Normally in practice, he seems very quiet, but he always managed to
to focus it all together during a race. And this is a sort of race where that attitude makes a big difference. It is it's the 500 toughest miles you will ever do.
Driving for Trevor Carlin, a very successful team owner fielding cars in development series in Europe and then starting in the United States a few years ago, has brought his team to the Verizon IndyCar Series for the first time. And Carlin with two entries here in this Indianapolis 500-mile race. Max Chilton drives the other. Chilton, 25th fastest in the qualification so far. And you see Kimball tracking right along the same lines.
You know, for Charlie, because he is so methodical, I think you're right, Eddie, because he really breaks down this race. I always broke it down into five 100-mile races, always working on the car, always thinking about what the car needs. And Charlie is one of those thinking drivers that he's known that in the paddock area. So if it's not maybe starting out so great at the beginning of the race, he will continue to work on the car and get the car better towards the end. So give him credit, because he's a driver that gets out there and does something that, you know, he's really gone out there to prove to people that if you have diabetes, it doesn't need to hold you back.
And it hasn't held him back at all.
Checkered flag for Charlie Kimball. Four-lap average, 225.752, 24th in line out of 33. Rick?
Well, standing by with last year's Indy 500 champion. You still have that title. He's not happy about his qualifying run, but you can be happy that you're still the defending champion. Let's talk about those four laps. You're not thrilled.
No, obviously, you know, back to the IMS, it's just an incredible feeling, you know, after last year. But, of course, today, we weren't happy, we weren't satisfied with, you know, I knew the car really didn't pull well, but obviously the guys did a hard job, you know, working really hard. There is so many things that had to be done, but it is a little shame, but I think what we got is what we got.
All right, once again, Takuma Sato, hopefully won't have to worry about scrambling at the end of this day.
All right, Rick, thanks. So Sato's sitting in 27th now, and one car left to make his guaranteed initial qualification attempt. It is Ed Carpenter. A two-time pole winner here at the Speedway. He did it in back-to-back years. First in 2013, setting off a massive celebration. This place meaning so much to Ed. And then a year later, the pole winner as well in 2014. Carpenter's cars showing a lot of speed, both in race trim earlier this week and now in yesterday's no-tow practice speeds. Carpenter was fourth overall behind Power Newgarden and Pagenaud. Does he have a shot to be fastest today? Well, certainly he has a good shot to be in the fast nine and have a shot at that pole position tomorrow.
He's had a great day today. He has Danica Patrick seventh, and I would not be shocked at all if he puts his car in the top three. He always manages to pluck something out of his car that really works for qualifying here, but it's a little bit different this year because the teams don't actually know the car that well, and it seems that Penske's resources have helped them get here with maybe a small 1 mile an hour advantage, Scott, compared to the other cars.
Tracking well on this first lap. It's early, but tracking well.
When I think of Ed Carpenter, Eddie, I think you guys are very similar. You were a driver owner. Ed Carpenter is a driver owner. Just the pressures of you guys owning the team, but being able to put your helmet on race day and sort of turn the switch, if you will, got to be a difficult thing to do.
It is, but in the end, the driver's side always wins out. Not always. Egotistically, I have to say that my car was probably the most important when I was sitting in it. Look at that.
You can hear the crowd.
29 for the first lap.
He's got something up his sleeve again.
And you can hear the roar of the crowd when it went by coming down here into turn one on the first lap.
That's only the third 229-mile-an-hour lap we've seen all day.
It's just as clean as can be. Follow the throttle.
Elio Castroneves' four-lap average speed was 228.919. You see Carpenter's average now just a whisker ahead, but with still another lap and a half to go.
But he started to drift wide coming out of two on that last lap. Remember,
we always talk about that the tires start to go off just a little bit. Car starts to handle different. You have to correct for that. Looked like that was a bit of a jerk of the steering wheel to get it away from the wall. Let's see what this one is.
Still good. Back a little bit. That's 228.6. Now tracking second. But again, the big thing here today, bring it home in one piece, close to the top spot, so you can compete for the pole tomorrow.
Yeah, but it's nice to go home the fastest car.
I know, but
you know, tomorrow's tomorrow. You go home tonight, and you've been the fastest car at Indy. That's big. That helps you tomorrow.
This isn't going to hurt him for tomorrow, for sure, if he brings it around this last corner cleanly.
Listen to the public.
Second fastest. Popular guy, hometown kid.
So how about
Butler University guy, team based here, and of course the family ties to the Speedway ownership group as well. So Ed Carpenter, second quickest, and the bumping has begun. Connor Daly has been bumped out of the field. Oriel Servia also out of the field, and now Servia is onto the track.
So what's going to happen now, Al, is they're going to start throwing darts at the board. They're going to start, well, we tried that. That didn't work. Let's try this. And those things rarely function. They don't work. And like what, 1 in 10 will work.
And what the engineers tell you and the team managers tell you before you get in the car, they say it should do this.
Not first, it does.
Yes.
Jan?
Yes, the issue with Oriel Servia, when you talk about engineers telling you what the car should do, they believe that the tire pressures did not come up enough for the ride height. In other words, the car was dragging on the ground, bottoming, which was the radio conversation that Servia had on this earlier run. We don't see the car bottoming at this point, so if the tire pressures come up and he gets the balance back, he should obviously have a much faster run.
Of all the Rahal drivers, he was the one that has been the most confident throughout the month.
You know, follow up something that Jan is talking about. When you go out there, and Jan drove here also, the car goes out, just sort of skims over the road just a little bit because the chassis is so low down to the ground. And as he talks about those tires getting warmer and the pressure's building, the car rises off the ground a little bit. It will no longer hit. And if you miscalculate on that, which it sounds like they did, you cannot have the car bottom because the car will certainly go out of control.
Boy, he has his work cut out for him now. He just hit a 223. He's got to do some mega laps to get this.
So Connor Daly is out of the top 33. Pippa Mann is on the bubble, and that's who Servia is trying to run faster than. Mann's four-lap average was 224.360.
Every lap you don't do at that pace makes it more difficult to catch up.
Second lap, 221.
So that's out. You can forget that. Sounds a bit harsh, but there is no way he's going to manage to get that average up to 225.
Well, when you think about his two teammates between Sato and Rahal, remember, they ran in the 225 range. So he was probably hoping just to be able to match that, to be close to the tail end, just to get in.
What I find shocking is all these cars are new, and Rahal has probably some of the best equipment in this series. How can their car be that much slower than Bourdais' car? Well, same engine, same chassis.
Sometimes, you know, you start down a road.
Yeah.
An engineering road or a direction with what you're doing, and it takes you some time to realize that maybe that's not the road you want to be on.
Well, they don't have much time to figure out which new map to follow.
Think of the people that have not made this race. Yeah. Rahal, his father, Bobby,
it happens, right?
Not made it before. Penske team's not made it before.
I'm responsible for that one, for his dad going home.
Oh, well,
I'm still troubled by that.
Not that much you are.
Yeah, I was going to say, I know you better than that.
So this is not fast enough to get it done for Oriel Servia. Right now he is tracking to put up the slowest four-lap average of the 35 cars. There's the white flag. Third lap will be down at 217. Sounds like it's kind of weird to say down at 217, but should be up in the at least the low 220s to mid 220s by the third lap to have any shot.
When we talk about those speeds, we're talking about the length of a football field in, well, less than a second.
They've waved the yellow. He's waved, his team has waved the yellow flag and called this off. So they want time in the remaining time.
Yes.
So Serbia still doesn't have a recorded qualification time. They want time to bring that car back in, throw another dart at it, like you said, Eddie, push him back to the front of the qualification line with no time and get back out on the track again because it wasn't happening there.
Alan, there's just not enough time to come up with a match. You can't just wave magic dust on it and it'll go 4 miles an hour quicker.
Well, that's
where I really feel for drivers in these moments because they... You know, you want to do everything you can. I've been in that position. It's a horrible place to be because you will take risks that normally you would never take.
A much better place to be is where Ed Carpenter sits on the scoring pylon. Right, Rick?
Yeah, you know, an awful lot of drivers have been getting out of the car, even drivers in the Fast 9, shaking their heads, not looking happy. You looked ecstatic when you got out of the car. Let's talk about the run.
Well, it was tough. I mean, the conditions are a lot harder than anything we've done in Q-Sims. And, you know, I was smiling because my car is crazy fast. You know, I probably could have been a little more brave and stuck it in there that fourth lap, but I was looking at the three times, trying to do math in my head, amongst other things, and figured I could be a little conservative that last lap and make sure we had a chance for the shootout tomorrow. So I was hoping it was still going to be good enough for P1, so I gave up a little bit too much, but... I'm happy with that. You know, the conditions are tough for the time of the day to put in a time like that. I think it really just is a testament to the team I have behind me. You know, they put me in this position before, and I try to not let them down by going out and getting four good laps. So, you know, Fuzzy's Vodka, Preferred Freezer, GoDaddy's on board now. That, you know, they give us all the tools we need to go out there and be successful. And obviously got to thank Chevrolet because you can see we got some power this year.
Right, Ed Carpenter, not just himself in that second position, but his whole team in the top nine right now.
Yeah, terrific, terrific effort for Carpenter. So there's the qualification line. Nobody in the fast lane on the concrete nearest the wall. But the driver who just left that lane to go onto the racetrack is Connor Daly. His team withdrawing his time. He's outside the top 33 anyway, so they've got to go out, and try again. The 26-year-old local product looking to see if they can find a little more speed. Pippa Mann is on the bubble. James Hinchcliffe is next in 32nd. So we will see if Daly can squeeze a little more out of this run than he had on the one before.
Unlike last year's cars, the majority of the downforce that these cars produce are produced with the underbody wing. And I think a lot of people are struggling, trying to figure out what they can do aerodynamically to take some drag. Drag is a negative of downforce. It's the cost of pushing something through the air. And these cars inherently have a lot of drag, so every time you try to take downforce off, it doesn't seem to work. And I've oversimplified a very complicated concept. But in the past, we knew what to do. You would just take out rear wing. And if you could hold on and put the belts on tight enough, you'd make it.
So Connor Daly is showing improved speed from his first run so far.
225.2.
But as you can see by the tracker, it's not in any way comfortably above the cut line.
But Alan, a car that's not handling well will burn through its tires much quicker than a car that is well balanced, like what Ed Carpenter was talking about. So he's putting a lot of pressure either on his front tires or his rear tires, and they will start to degrade. And a tire that's degrading at 230 miles an hour is no fun.
That is Connor's mom. Saw his dad before. Really, we talked to her yesterday morning. Watching him struggle to try and make the race, that's how much it means to everyone involved.
Well, their whole family has done everything they can to get him in this car, and if willpower will do it, his mom has a lot of that right now.
One lap to go. That one at 224.4. His average needs to stay above 224.360. That's what Pippa Mann posted, but that'd only get him back onto the bubble.
Back on the track. And, you know, the fourth lap is always the most difficult because, as you're talking about, when the tire is going away, Eddie, you have to make sure you run the perfect line. And right now, his lines seem to be picture perfect. He just hopes that the car has enough speed.
Let's see what
checkered
he does.
Checkered flag for Connor Daly. And it will be up into 33rd. Four lap average, 224.736. Pippa Mann is bumped from the field. And we're getting down to it on bump day here at the Brickyard.
Sunday, May 27th on ABC. Telecast presented by Firestone.
Back live on bump day at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway at 5:50 p.m. Qualifications will end, and two drivers are going to go home without being in the Indianapolis 500. Jack Harvey out, making a second qualification attempt. His first run was a 225.233 mile an hour average that has him 30th on the grid. You see at the moment on the rerun, he's up to 25th. So this could prove four laps worth taking if this last circuit goes well for Harvey.
Reason for doing this, as you mentioned, if he gets a bit further up the grid, he gets further away from that bubble zone.
And I think he's safe good. With that. I think he's going to be okay with that. There's
up to 27th. Up to 27th at 225.720. Picked up a half a mile an hour in the four-lap average speed for Jack Harvey. So Connor Daly on the bubble. Pippa Mann and Oriel Servia on the outside looking in. And Ryan Hunter-Reay, who sits 13th, going to go out next in line to try and see if he can make the fast nine to have a shot at a front row starting spot in tomorrow's shootout. Clock is ticking toward the end of bump day here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Hunter-Reay on the track next. Back live on bump day at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Ryan Hunter-Reay trying to improve from 13th position to see if he can make the fast nine and have a shot at pole position tomorrow for next weekend's greatest spectacle in racing. You see he's tracking 12th right now, not improving enough to make that fast nine. The winner of a few years ago, looking to see if he can squeeze a little bit more speed somehow on these final couple of laps around.
And as we watch his hands on the left-hand side of the screen, drivers that turn the steering wheel the least amount generally have the quickest car. So it seems like a lot of turning going into the steering wheel right there. There's a lot of angles on the front wheel, scrubbing off speed. The car is balanced perfectly, probably close to what Elio Castroneves has, if you can recall. When we watched his run, he was certainly a guy that had the opportunity to not turn the steering wheel very much.
Tell me about attitude difference, going out with a time already in the books and just trying to see if you can do better versus some of these people a little more desperate at the back of the grid. Is there some protection in the way you're driving here if you're Hunter-Reay?
When you're a driver of Hunter-Reay's quality, you're always full throttle. So the changes he would make would be technical changes to the car, and he drives around it. But he never had any doubt that he was going to take any throttle out. The cars that are lower down in the field, their balance is not as good, and they will have to focus just on the throttle issue.
He picked up just slightly from 226.91 to 226.95, but still sits in 13th position. The Idle two-night finale event is coming up. Incredible performances from judges Katie, Luke, and Lytle, plus special celebrity guests. Answering, of course, the big question, who'll be named the next American Idol? Two-night finale live on ABC, starting at 8, 7 Central, tomorrow. So, Oriel Servia, now beginning his third attempt to qualify for the Indianapolis 500. Connor Daly is on the bubble. Pippa Mann has begun strapping back into her car. Jan, what have they done to this 64 to try and rub a little magic into it?
Well, you heard Eddie talk about the magic dust. What they're trying is a little higher tire pressure, about 1.5 PSI all the way around. They've taken some front wing out to take some of the downforce because Oriel said the car was loose and also adjusted the ride height. So three big changes. We'll see if, in fact, that turns out to be magic dust.
Loose meaning the back end of the car wanted to come around. The front had more grip than the back, so trying to balance that out, take a little of the grip out of the front and see if you can get a little speed.
And that's
both
the worst.
Laughing. Yeah. Loose around Indy is not a good place to be. What you want is you want a car when you get at the end of the corner, the front starts getting a little bit light because you can tune. But when you start turning into the car, into the corner, and the back starts sliding, those are the worst accidents to have because you lose control and there's nothing you can do but just ride it.
He needs to be faster on his four-lap average than 224.736. That is where Connor Daly sits, no doubt nervously.
And a 223.2 warm-up is pretty good.
Boy, these new cars must be really difficult to tune. I've never seen so many troubled faces after practice as I have at every race we've been to this year, and this is no different.
I'd like to say it's the same for everybody. It's massaging the car with the engineer's knowledge to get it to the driver's liking. The balance that we hear the drivers talk about is a car that doesn't have understeer, doesn't have oversteer. It goes through the turn just as nicely as it can, as we're going to watch.
Good lap.
There we go.
It's a 225.4, as you can see.
That's a big jump from what we've done before. A big jump.
Now, the consistency that you've been talking about, Eddie, we've only seen the Penske cars really start to increase their speeds as the runs go on. Right now, it's tuning to track conditions with the available cockpit adjustments the drivers have to make sure the car stays at that speed.
Whatever they did is working because he is a lot smoother than he was before. And I guarantee you, his heart rate's down about 30%.
Second another lap, one. 225.236. You see the tracker, the yellow number on the ruler, is showing that right now Serbia is in 29th place.
And he's got about a foot left on the track.
And so this is, and I'm looking at you and I say this and I think you know where I'm going to go. This is when you're counting the turns. Two more laps, four turns per lap, and you're counting the turns off going, okay, seven more turns.
He's doing it. He's doing it. Ray Hall's engineers have figured something out.
Now on his second attempt, his third lap was only 217.9 miles an hour. This time the number is 225.4, so they have found some magic in that wing and air pressure adjustments that Jan was detailing for us a minute ago.
That was great reporting. To be able to get that out, of an engineer,
you were saying?
Doesn't happen very often. Boy, when he came out of the corner, he had a lot of steering in there, and he was into the gray. If you get too far into the gray, you just don't have any grip. There's nothing you can do.
You see, he lost a little position on the tracker, so now in 30th here, coming off his final corner.
It's going to be better than 224.5.
To the checkered flag with Connor Daly sitting on the bubble. Oriel Servia about to record his first completed qualification attempt today in 31st place. Daly is out. James Hinchcliffe goes down onto the bubble. And the clock continues to tick. 25, 27 minutes left to go in bump day at Indy. Scott Dixon helping us remind you tonight it's game three of the NBA Eastern Conference Finals, Celtics Cavaliers, ESPN. Coverage starting at 7:30 Eastern with NBA Countdown. Of course, it streams on the ESPN app with the Celtics heading to Cleveland, up 2-0. What? Scott Dixon came out in 9th position, did not withdraw his time. This is a rerun from the protected lane, trying to see if he can improve. Be sure he's in that fast 9 for a shot at pole position tomorrow. His time on his first run, the four-lap average, was 227.591. Right now, his four-lap average is 227.891 with this half a lap to go.
But it's dropping. The speeds are dropping lap by lap.
And Eddie, you and I have done this because you can see him tuning the car, probably by the weight jacker there in the steering wheel, by just a push of a button. When we come out of turn four here, and I know we're coming down to the checkered flag, but watch how dark it gets, because you come up to the grandstands on the right-hand side. As he enters into turn one, you'll see the big shadow right there. You're entering in there at 230-plus miles an hour underneath a big shadow this time of day. Very difficult to do.
Picked it up. Moves up to eighth place, 227.782. So picked up a couple of tenths of a mile an hour. Moves ahead of Danica Patrick. Puts Danica down onto the ninth position. Again, for that cut line to make the fast nine shootout tomorrow. The real difficult end of the business here as we run out these final 22 and a half minutes of bump day are these drivers scrambling to be in the 33 car field. Connor Daly outside of the 33, so they've withdrawn the time that they had set earlier, moved up to the head of the fast lane, and here he is out onto the track to make yet again a third attempt to qualify for the 500. James Hinchcliffe is on the bubble. Four-lap average of 224.784. Pippa Mann also strapped into her car and in that fast lane. Hinchcliffe's car is not in the fast lane yet. He's about third back in the protect your time lane, Jan. And for Connor Daly's team, they continue to search for little things to gain him a little gap.
Yes, they do, of course. Both these two cars that are in the fast lane, Connor Daly, who just left the fast lane, now we see Pippa Mann rolling up. Obviously, both owned by Dale Coyne. Just spoke with him and said, we think we have an opportunity to run both these two cars twice before 550. We're going for it. We've made subtle changes for Connor. He didn't need too much. He thinks this may not be the last run for either car. I think they have more time to play with.
Well, what that has to be like for those drivers.
I'm just thinking, mentally taxing. Eddie, when you and I first got here, you had one run, and that was your run that you had to put yourself in the field, and wherever it was, that's where you qualified. Now with this multiple attempts, I don't know how the drivers sleep the night before.
They always manage to find a way. They always manage. Let's see if he went any quicker. A little bit. Tracking 30th.
But tracking it over four laps. Now, our track conditions coming to them. The track temperature has dropped a couple of degrees by that shadow across the front stretch, though it's still beaming down pretty brightly on turn two and turn three.
When you're testing here before the Indy 500 as a driver, you just love it when that shadow starts coming down because you pick up so much grip in turn one and turn two. And the engine just runs better and the cars just get faster. So a lot of this right now in these last 20 minutes is going to be about finding yourself on the track at the last moment. I think you might be able to find that half a mile that you need to get in.
He is using a lot of road, guys.
Early on.
Yes. But the lines look terrific. Love the way he sweeps up to the wall. I call it Rick Mears classic line. Gives himself a little bit more room on the exit of three that time.
So Daly, his last run averaged 224.736. You see he's at 224.9 here with a couple of laps to go. James Hinchcliffe is 224.784. for a four-lap average. But again, just topping that for Connor Daly is only going to put him right back on the bubble. He really needs to be up closer to 225 miles an hour flat for the four-lap average.
Yes. And I think to do that, he's going to have to start off with the 226 because every run he's done, he's gotten slower and slower every lap into the run.
So he'll come here to see the white flag. One more lap to go in this qualification attempt. Tracking right at 32nd, 33rd.
There really is nothing he can do right now to go any faster.
No, he's flat out. He's doing everything the car has, he's putting out there.
You have to focus so much. You can't be stressed. You'll make a mistake.
It's really like riding a horse, because a horse knows when you're nervous so close to the wall. The steering wheel in this race car knows if you're nervous also.
Checkered flag for Connor Daly, 32nd. James Hinchcliffe is bumped.
My goodness. I would have never said, Alan, starting the month, that Hinchcliffe would have been on the bubble.
And right away, the Schmidt-Peterson team moves that Hinchcliffe car from the line of protected times over to the withdraw your timeline, or they're trying to. They're having a conversation with series officials there.
Well, he doesn't have a time anymore, so off he needs to go.
Well, they just have to go through the process.
The technical stuff, you signing the paperwork.
That's right.
So that business.
Get the officials down there, yep. Sign the paper, turn it in, see, there you go.
You think about it.
Vince struggled the whole month.
About a previous pole sitter to now just getting bumped out, this track shows no favoritism, does it?
This is Indy, baby. It doesn't show favoritism to anybody. I remember 1 year watching all the Penske cars not qualify. And the year before, they had won the race. Dominated. Right?
Yeah, won in 94, did not qualify in 95.
Did not qualify. And all of the pits, all the teams moved down to see Penske try to solve the problem. And that time they didn't, right at the end of practice.
So Hinch's team has signed the paperwork, withdrawn the previous time. Here they come into the fast lane, up toward the front of the line. They'll be the next car onto the speedway. Pippa Mann is on the track now. On the outside, looking in, seeing if she can bump James Davison out of the field of 33. Which would in turn put Connor Daly right back on the bubble. And on the angst goes until these next 16 and a half minutes go by.
I would not discount Pippa. The more she runs, she tends to get, like everybody does, she becomes more confident. So I'm very curious to see how this run goes, but regardless of how it goes, she has a humongous amount of courage coming up here every year without doing any other racing in IndyCars and doing as well as she does at the Speedway. She really needs to be commended.
Well, not only for being on the racetrack, but she does such a great job in the community because she lives here in Indianapolis, and every month you see her on television doing something locally, a lot of times with young girls and just proving that girls can go off and follow their dreams. And when we spoke to her the other day, like Alan mentioned, she was just so stressed out that she might have to go into this exact scenario that she's in right now and have to try and re-qualify time and time again just to get into the field.
First lap is a 224.3.
She needs to top a four-lap average of 224.798. So you keep an eye on that average mile per hour number to see whether Mann is in. And here's the thing. We're talking about fractions of a second. Right now, from 31st to 33rd, so what is the last row of the 500, the qualified cars? Over four laps, they're separated by 148 one-thousandth of a second, 0.148.
And yet it might as well be half an hour.
You know? It's forever in its meaning.
Yes.
Now, when you watch her car, she comes off the turn. You see a little bit of movement in the car that's costing her speed. She's not confident with the way the car is exiting the turn, and she sort of just tugs it back down.
No, it just does not look fast. She's got so much track left. She just doesn't seem to be carrying a lot of speed, and I'm going back to that throttle pattern again. She's been full throttle from the second she left the pits.
And the third lap here, a little slower, lost a half a mile an hour.
It's not going to happen.
So what ends up happening now is the car is not working for her, so she's turning the steering wheel more into the turn, scrubbing off speed. The car gets dragged down, the RPMs in the engine get dragged down. She can feel that as a driver. You know it just by what they call the seat of your pants, and she also gets confirmation every time she goes across the start and finish line because on her electronic dash, it tells her lap time instantaneously.
So this is not looking fast enough. And they have waved off the attempt. So Dale Coyne saying, nope, that's not going to get us in. Let's bring it back. Let's cool it down. Let's try something else.
Remember, one of Dale Coyne's cars for days is P5.
Yes.
The same car, same engine, same pieces.
So Pippa Mann and company will have to come back and try again. So James Davison continues to sit on the bubble. James Hinchcliffe will be next on the track. 13 minutes and change left to go.
Boy, I can feel the tension just sitting here.
trying to empty his head of everything, of everything. All he has to go out there and do is drive this thing as fast as he can and let it be what it's going to be.
What I always did is when I left the pit lane right here, get through up onto the track into turn one.
There's his parents.
And turn two. Then I would turn around, a couple of deep breaths going down the back stretch, and try to relax. Easier said than done.
I thought you were going to give me another horse analogy.
The 2016 pole winner. Amazing. Amazing. And he's having to fight to get the last place on the grid. Now, remember earlier today when Hinch made his run, the one that they've just withdrawn the time from, he was the car sitting at the head of the line when the first rainstorm hit. And they sat there for 2 hours and 21 minutes and then went out onto the racetrack to make his four-lap attempt. You heard his teammate, Robert Wickens, who was the first car out on the track after the second. Rick, something going on?
Want to point out on the radio just a few moments ago as he was pulling out, first they had told him, weave from side to side, get some heat in the tires, we want you to do that for us. But immediately after he did that, he said, I've got a wicked vibration. He said it twice. Then a moment later he came back and said, wait, I think it's going to go away. And then he came back on one last time and said, I think it's going to go away. Ooh. But now it looks like they're still going to have a problem, and now they're talking about waving him into the pit box.
They have done that, Rick. He's come onto the warm-up road. His crew running up the pit lane from the turn one end to the turn four end where that car will come. That's no short task, but the clock continuing to tick on James Hinchcliffe. Listen to this.
Very, 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 very bad rotation. Vibration. Very bad vibration.
You can hear that in his voice.
Yeah.
Copy. Can you run it or do you want to pit for another set of tires?
Going away. It's going away.
Copy. Pit it.
No, it's going away.
Copy, going away.
No, it's coming back.
Chaos as the clock counts down on bump day at Indianapolis. We're back after this message and a word from your ABC station. Day at Indianapolis, Graham Rahal is on the track trying to improve his time from 30th place, but the real drama is here. After James Hinchcliffe got bumped and had to pull off because of a vibration, Pippa Mann's car got to the front of the line ahead of his, and that clock you see ticking down to the end of qualification. They're both at tech. They get to top their fuel to do the things they have to do before they get to the head of the line. So nobody's holding anybody up from anything for the moment. But will James Hinchcliffe even get a chance to get on the racetrack to try and get back into the field? The clock is ticking. At this point, it doesn't look good for Hinch. Rahal, running his fourth of four laps, has completed his circuits at an average of 225.167. Graham is in 30th place. And James Davison is still on the bubble with time winding down on bump day. Neither of the two cars in the fast lane were at the head of the line and ready. So here's Alexander Rossi out on the track. He's in 16th position, trying to see if he can find a way to get into the fast nine. Will any positions change in these final 6 minutes? Back at Indianapolis, 3 minutes to go on bump day. James Hinchcliffe is two cars away from getting a shot to get on the racetrack, fifth in the championship, entering this Indianapolis 500, a double points event. But Pippa Mann is ahead of him in line. Mann herself trying to find a way to bump into the 500. Rossi trying to find a way into the fast nine to have a shot at pole tomorrow. He's coming down to complete his four-lap qualification run and has a shot at doing it. Checkered flag is up for the former winner. He'll miss it by a car. 10th for Alexander Rossi.
And Danica Patrick is in the fast nine. How about that for a return?
Yeah. So 2 minutes left, and the track will become available to Pippa Mann. And all James Hinchcliffe could do is sit, listen to his heartbeat, and watch the seconds tick away.
But if Pippa Mann goes out and she sees that she cannot better that time after a first or second lap, she has the option of coming in the pits.
She does, but that time is going to be about at zero before she even finishes her warm-up laps and gets on that first lap before you even record that first time. You know, so the chances of it are pretty slim. Here's the rule for the end of qualifying. Basically, the track has to be available to you. The car has to be running, and you have to be rolling when the qualifying period ends.
If she's going to do it, we have to see what, not this lap, but the next lap. And there's 1 minute and 9 seconds left.
You know, it's interesting, guys, because this brings up a very interesting point that for the part-time racers that are here this month, they certainly get a chance to try and qualify for this event. But for the franchise holders, for the teams that run on a constant basis here in the IndyCar series, James Hinchcliffe being one of the drivers for the Sam Schmidt organization with Rick Peterson, their car right now is sitting on the outside, not with the opportunity to get in. So that's got to bring up some consideration, I think.
James Hinchcliffe is not going to qualify for this year's Indianapolis 500.
Green flag, and Pippa Mann has the final shot. Four laps to try and knock James Davison out of the 500 field. Davison's four-lap average, 224.798. That's the number to beat for Pippa Mann.
Wow, what a day.
Gutted for Sam.
That's a very big blow to his team.
And for James Hinchcliffe. First lap for Pippa Mann, 223.9. Needs an average of 224.7. Almost 224.8. James sitting there in disbelief.
Boy, oh boy. Her car does not have that speed in it. It takes months, Alan, to prepare for this race. Months of special projects, special cars. And for a team like Sam's to not have one of his lead drivers in the 500 is devastating.
223.17 as Mann continues to try and find a way to piece it together. But James Hinchcliffe will not be in the Indianapolis 500. You know, it's what this day is all about. He had his chance earlier, did get a run in, didn't go fast enough. And you know that they are just devastated. White flag. James Davison sits on the bubble. As sore as he was from his practice accident yesterday, this is just as agony for him, watching, waiting, hoping. Though relief may be on its way in about another 30 seconds.
No, he's in. Oh, my goodness. From pole to not qualifying.
Final corners for Pippa Mann. And final moments to set the starting grid for the Indianapolis 500. The 33 drivers that will be in the field. Checkered flag is in the air. And bump day is over. Mann not fast enough. Pippa Mann and James Hinchcliffe will not make the Indianapolis 500. James Davison will make the cut right on the number. Heartbreak for Hinch. The drama, the excitement, the heartbreak of bump day in Indianapolis has just played itself out before our very eyes as a fan favorite goes home while others scrape by and barely make the 500 by the tips of their fingernails. The dreamers who dream of being part of this great race accomplish it by the slimmest of margins. I speak of Connor Daly and James Davison, who will take up the last two spots on the grid. And we look now at the results of qualification day. Here are the nine drivers that will compete for the pole tomorrow in the Fast 9 Shootout here on ABC, starting at 4 Eastern time with Elio Castroneves, the three-time champion, setting the fastest speed today.
Driving for Penske, and you would certainly expect that from Team Penske in 10th on through 21st right there. A lot of talented drivers, a lot of talented teams that are now going to be working on race setup. Remember, we do re-qualify everybody tomorrow. The top nine are what we're going to be watching for on ABC starting at 4 o'clock, and it's going to be a real shootout tomorrow, Alan.
And you see that bottom line, the two who don't make this year's Indianapolis 500. Just a moment ago, Jan Beekes spoke with James Hinchcliffe.
James, I know a lot of emotions going through your mind right now. It looked like you were going to have time, and at the last moment you realized you did not. What's the thought process knowing that you thought you had the timing right on the previous run?
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's devastating in every way possible. You know, we got in line there, and we had a tire vibration. I'm not exactly sure what the problem was, but, you know, it's one of those things. Indy's a cruel mistress sometimes. You know, highest to highs, lowest to lows, but, you know, everybody at SPM worked their tails off to get these cars ready. We have three cars in the show. Unfortunately, the fourth one didn't make it, but we win as a team, we lose as a team. It's crazy to be here after where we were 2 years ago, you know, but... We'll put our heads down. We'll take a look at it. We'll definitely learn from this experience. It's a character builder for all of us, for sure. But, yeah, just disappointed. It's, you know, the aero car is fast enough to be in the show, no doubt about it. We got one of the best crews in pit lane. We've proved that on pit lane all year long. It's a big blow for sure.
You mentioned pole position in the past a couple of years ago. What changed during that time? There's a new aero kit, but what else is different?
I mean, you know, there's a lot of things. It's year to year, it's very different, you know. But like I said, what matters is we came here with big expectations and high hopes. And, you know, we knew over the month that we didn't have maybe fast nine speed, but we certainly didn't worry about being out of the show. And, you know, we had a bit of a problem in our first run. The second run, it looks like the track was getting a little bit cooler, a little bit quicker. But we just had that problem. And honestly, in the car, I thought the gun went at six. So I wasn't even really worried about it. And we just didn't get out in front of Pippa there, and it's the rules. It's how it goes. You know, we're not the first, you know, big name, big car to go home in this race. That's Indy. We finally have bumping again, which everybody was super thrilled about, and I'm a little less thrilled about it now than I was 24 hours ago. But yeah, I mean, you gotta take your lumps here sometimes.
Thank you, James.
Thanks.
For perspective, 3 years ago, James Hinchcliffe did not make this race because he was in a hospital bed fighting for his life after a crash. Here he didn't make the race, but he'll walk away just bitterly disappointed. There's the menu. Tomorrow, the run for the pole. We start with deciding positions 33 through 10, then the Fast 9 Shootout here on ABC, leading up to the Indianapolis 500 pre-race show and telecast 1 week from tomorrow. Heartbreak for Pippa Man. Heartbreak for James Hinchcliffe. And up next on ABC World News or your local news, except on the West Coast, the run for the pole tomorrow at Indy. What a day on Bump Day.